I'm calling to order this hearing. This is a public hearing of the Committee of the Whole. I'm Phil Mendelson, Chairman of the Council, Chair of the Committee of the Whole. Today is Thursday, April 6, 2017. The time is 10:16 in the morning. We are in room 500 of the council chambers of the Johnny Wilson Building. This is the hearing. It's a little different than our usual hearing, where we receive the mayor, who formally presents the budget for her proposal for the fiscal year 2018 budget to the council. And I want to thank Mayor Bowser for being here and with your team. The purpose of today's hearing is for Mayor Bowser to present her fiscal year 2018 budget and proposed financial plan to the council. Members will be given an opportunity to provide opening remarks, then we will hear testimony from Mayor Bowser and the Chief Financial Officer, Jeff DeWitt. Each member of the council will be afforded one 10-minute round with the mayor and the CFO or anybody at the table, and then one additional 10-minute round with the city administrator and the chief financial officer. And the mayor doesn't have to be here for that second round. But I, again, want to thank you. I want to thank you, Mayor Bowser, City Administrator Rashad Young, Budget Director Matt Brown, and the entire team on the executive side for the countless hours spent completing your third budget. Congratulations. I also want to thank the Chief Financial Officer, Jeff DeWitt, Gordon McDonald, Fitzroy Lee, and your team for compiling and certifying yet another budget. We'll continue to put you through that stress for the next couple of months. The council looks forward to working with you over the next 54 days as we review, modify, and consider the fiscal year 2018 budget. The district's finances have never been better. Our pensions are fully funded. We have almost met our best practice goal of having a rainy day fund equaling 60 days of operating cash with $1.165 billion in our reserves. We also just had one of the best quarters on record in terms of revenue growth. Moreover, the district now has the distinct honor of having the most progressive personal income tax structure in the country. We also have a business income tax that's on par with Maryland's and the lowest residential real property tax rate in the region. The resources available to the mayor when pulling together the fiscal year 2018 budget are, in a word, incredible. On top of 4% revenue growth, the mayor was able to access an additional $100 million from extraordinary savings in our pension contribution and from prior commitments to the Housing Production Trust Fund and to Metro. Additionally, the proposed fiscal year 2018 budget is balanced by carrying over $183 million from fiscal year 2017 to spend in fiscal year 2018. I'm now going to say some cautionary words about the budget, and if one thinks I'm being critical, my comments apply to the council as well as the executive. For about as long as I can remember, we have been shifting one-time revenues from the current fiscal year into the next fiscal year to balance the budget. This is nothing new. In addition, we are borrowing hundreds of millions of dollars every year for capital expenses. It would not be incorrect to state that we are spending considerably more each year than we raise in operating revenue, even though we are operating in the black. But structurally, we are making our fiscal future more difficult. We should start using the carryover funds and breathtaking revenue growth more resourcefully. We should spend them on initiatives that reduce needs in our fiscal future. For instance, the CFO recommends that we add an additional $325 million per year to pay-as-you-go or pay-go capital starting in fiscal year 2019 to get the district's assets in a state of good repair by fiscal year 2026. This will be a heavy lift, and it would be made easier if we applied some of the 4.4% revenue growth received this year. Instead, the revenue growth expands spending on programs. Alternatively, we could dedicate one-time carryover funds to PAYGO rather than using them to cover operating expenses. We could also dedicate a portion of our revenue growth to PAYGO capital as well. This is a missed opportunity, but as I said, the council shares responsibility in this. Besides the obvious benefit of maintaining the district schools, libraries, recreation centers, and roads, increasing pay-as-you-go spending would lessen our need to borrow, lower our debt service obligation, which is approaching $1 billion per year. That is, we will soon be spending $1 billion annually just on interest. And increasing PAYGO dollars is a great strategy to insulate the district from uncertain federal grants, the Trump effect, and a possible economic downturn. I'm looking forward to reviewing the proposed budget over the next 54 days with an eye toward more effective utilization of district resources. Indeed, we can expand many programs merely by ensuring that dollars are spent effectively. Starting tomorrow, committees will begin hearing public and executive testimony on the proposed budget. You can find the calendar on the council's website. On May 12th, the Committee of the Whole will hold an overall public hearing on the local and federal budget acts, as well as the Budget Support Act. Markups will be held by the committees May 16th through May 18th, and the council will have its first reading on May 30th. I will turn now to my colleagues for opening statements, which will be limited to the same amount of time that I just took. I will begin by recognizing Councilmember Robert White.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Madam Mayor. I want to start by congratulating you and your team for putting together what will be the district's 22nd consecutive balanced budget. I know all the hard work that you put into this proposal, and I appreciate you being here today to walk us through it. While I have a lot of questions, not all of which I will be able to ask today, I was happy to see that we share many of the same priorities. It's clear from your budget recommendations that we both value investments in workforce development, affordable housing, education, particularly in early childhood, and support for our returning citizens. I also want to thank you for meeting with me as you were finalizing your budget proposal. Of course, there were some areas where I remained concerned. In every financial report and forecast, it is clear that the city is more economically prosperous than it has ever been. However, we lack a stable middle class, and the poor in our city are getting poorer, not richer. Our finances will not always be so strong. That's the reality of changing markets. And when our fortune changes, we won't have the opportunity to invest as much in growing our middle class and lifting our poor into positions of opportunity. We have to make the necessary investments while we have the resources. I was disappointed that in a nearly $14 billion budget, that we will add nearly 1,100 new district government employees, we were unable to make greater investments in permanent supportive housing, targeted affordable housing, and rapid rehousing for our homeless individuals and families. While I appreciate the new investments we made to close the budget gap in homeless services and the money you found to move forward the DC General Replacement Plan, we simply have to do better to solve our homelessness crisis. Every day I walk into work, I pass many of my constituents who have ended up homeless after being dealt a bad hand to begin with. In addition, I felt that more could have been done to produce and preserve affordable housing so that our families do not end up homeless in the first place. I've seen the impact of our affordable housing crisis on members of my own family that have been pushed out of the district due to rising rents. On education, I was surprised to see that you did not expand the school transit subsidy program to subsidize residents enrolled in adult education programs, as that was a recommendation from the Deputy Mayor for Education. I would have also liked to see funding in the budget to fully fund and enact the 2014 Special Education Reform legislation, which would identify and serve more children with developmental delays. Of course, I recognize that every budget requires some hard choices, even in a city as prosperous as this one. So I look forward to better understanding your strategy. While I do not chair a committee myself, I intend to work closely with my colleagues over the next few weeks to ensure that we are allocating our resources as efficiently as possible so that we spend every possible dollar where it will make the biggest impact for our residents, making sure we have quality, accessible education from early childhood through adulthood, making sure that every district resident has a safe, clean, affordable place to call home, making sure that there are training, that we are training all of our residents to take advantage of the extraordinary opportunities we have in the district, and making sure that when people do go down the wrong path, we give them a real chance to turn their lives around. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Madam Mayor, for being here.
Thank you, Councilmember White. To Councilmember Evans.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Good morning, everyone. Good morning, Mayor and your staff. And I want to take this opportunity to thank you, City Administrator Young, and your entire team for putting together what I view as a very good budget for the District of Columbia. Some specific observations. First of all, as many of you know, the district continues to be a very prosperous city. This year, we have more revenue to spend than we've ever had in the history of the city. As many of you know, we just had the best quarter that we've ever had in the history of the city. So revenues continue to increase in all categories: sales tax, income tax, property tax, deed and recordation tax. We are flush with money. It's important to remember that. This year's budget will be the largest budget in the history of the city, again, because we have the resources to spend. And that's not a bad thing, it's actually a good thing. We have resources, we have ability to deal with many of the issues facing the city. So I want to keep that in perspective, because all of us get the emails and the calls that we're not spending enough money. We are spending more money today than we have ever spent. Some of you may remember, I've been here a while. I point that out every once in a while. I've been here 26 years now. And I remember a time when we weren't in this situation. I remember a time when we had to cut. Imagine this council and this administration being faced with cutting 10% out of their budget. It wasn't even that long ago, Councilmember and Mayor Gray, when we had to deal with that, remember? Cutting things out of the budget. But we don't have to do that today. We have the resources. I'm happy that this budget addresses the main priorities of the city. Schools, number one. We are going to spend, this is the largest amount we have ever spent in our school budget this year. So we are putting an enormous amount into schools. On affordable housing, the mayor has kept her commitment to spend another $100 million a year in the Housing Production Trust Fund. More than we've ever spent before. Last year we did, this year. I think it's important to always remember that spending more money doesn't necessarily get you better results. Spending more money sometimes gets you less results because the capacity doesn't exist to produce what your end goal is. My concern is when we spend, I'll use the Housing Production Trust Fund for example, $100 million, am I getting $100 million worth of houses? Or am I only getting $50 million worth of houses? Or what am I getting? If I spend $200 million, would I get $200 million worth of housing? Or would I get declining results because of capacity, our ability to produce these things? And so I think many times we celebrate the spending of the money and not the end result. I've seen that too much in our history here in the city. And so that's why I think the amount that the mayor has put in her budget is the right amount, not a higher amount that may not be used in the fashion that we're attempting to get there. On WMATA, as you know, I chair the board of WMATA, and WMATA is the looming problem for this city and for our region. It is the time bomb that will go off next year. And I'm pleased to see that mayor has fully funded the request from WMATA on both the operating and the capital side. Next year, we are not going to be able to do that. The amount being requested is far greater than what we or the region is going to be able to afford. I will say it over and over again, the district gets it, I think the region doesn't, and sometime between now and a year and a half from now, the region's gonna wake up to the fact that there's not enough money in any of our budgets to fully fund WMATA's capital needs, and we're gonna need a dedicated tax in this region. We are there, the region is not. But at some point, they will wake up and discover that that's what's important. So in the major priorities, again, schools, housing, transportation, this budget addresses the concerns that I have and that I believe that the city has. There's one area that I'm going to be looking to find a little more money in, and that's the arts. The mayor has funded the arts with $20 million, and I thank you. I have made a commitment to the arts advocates that we would try to get to $25 million in our arts commission, and so I'll be looking with my colleagues and my own budget to see if we can find that extra $5 million. The arts are critical for our city. And frankly, with the concerns on the national front of defunding the National Endowment for the Arts, we will lose money that we would have otherwise have gotten. So the arts are a very important part of our city, and I would like to see if we can do something to address that. And finally, as my time runs out, I want to support and echo the concerns my chairman has. We are running into a problem on debt. This is a chart you really can't see, but it shows the escalation in debt. From 1984, when we first started, had the ability to borrow money, our debt was about $1.9 billion. In 10 years, we doubled that. In 1994, it was almost $4 billion. By 2014, we doubled that again at $8 billion. And as we go forward by 2023, if we are on the track we're on now, we will be at over $10 billion. It will be the second or third largest entity in the government is our debt service. And so as we go forward, we have to be very careful about borrowing to pay expenses. It reminds me, and Jeff and I had this discussion of our children. They have a card. My daughter's up in New York. She swipes the card, and dad puts the money in the account. So she has no reason not to swipe the card, because dad will always put the money in the account until dad's going to say no more money in the account. So in translated into our government, we have to be careful about swiping the card too many times. So thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mayor, again, congratulations, your staff, for submitting a very good budget to the council.
Thank you, Councilmember Evans. Councilmember Todd?
Yes, thank you, Chairman, and thank you, Mayor Bowser, City Administrator Young, Chief Financial Officer DeWitt, for your hard work on this year's proposed budget. Congratulations on another successful fiscal year in the District of Columbia, and I know that the residents appreciate your leadership in bringing us a budget that moves us forward and keeps us at the forefront of innovative cities. Washington, D.C. is a growing and thriving city, and your proposed budget supports inclusive economic growth, reflecting an investment in creating opportunities for all district residents. I'm particularly glad to see your continued commitment to DC Public Schools Modernization Program. $1.3 billion over the next 6 years will ensure that every District of Columbia student has access to a first-class education. This budget continues to fully fund the modernization of Calvin Coolidge Middle and High School, which will be completed in 2019. West Education Campus will get a slight increase in funding, and Dorothy Height has been added to the six-year CIP, and this is good news. I appreciate your commitment to investing resources at Petworth Recreation Center, a community facility at Shepherd Elementary School, and investments at Upshur Park. District neighborhoods will also see increases in infrastructure investments of approximately $4.6 million per ward, and I know I'm anxious to work with VDOT to get that moving. Thank you again for the 14th Street expanded bus service that you announced last week. It will make a huge difference to the overall transportation plan for Upper Northwest Washington, D.C., helping wards 4, 1, and 2. And I'm also pleased that this budget fully funds the district's share of WMATA's operating and capital subsidies. I commend this administration for once again investing in $100 million in the Housing Production Trust Fund. These continued investments in affordable housing are necessary to help district residents secure a stable living environment and is fundamental to forging a path out of poverty. And I am pleased that we are looking at new preservation money as well. In my ward, there are several projects that focus on allowing existing tenants to stay in their home while getting upgrades or full refurbished units. This money will help ensure that district residents can stay in their homes. The safety of all district residents is important to me, especially in my ward, where last year we saw the largest decrease of overall crime. And I want to ensure that we keep this down, and I'm pleased that this proposed budget includes significant investments in public safety, including nearly $12 million focused on recruiting and retaining Metropolitan Police Department officers. As we look to increasing opportunities to grow a strong middle class, I am pleased to see investments in the Marion S. Berry Summer Youth Employment Program, the Washington, D.C. Infrastructure Academy at St. Elizabeth's East Campus, and the Certified Business Enterprise Program. Each of these and countless other ways we are reaching residents in need of jobs, training, and business opportunities demonstrates this city's commitment to a thriving economy. As the budget process moves forward, I will continue working with you and your staff, as well as my colleagues on the council, to ensure that this government puts in place a fiscally responsive budget that reinvests in the district's future, supports inclusive economic growth, and meets the diverse needs of all of our residents. Thank you, Mayor Bowser, and thank you to your team.
Thank you, Councilmember Todd. Councilmember Treon White.
Thank you. Good morning. I wanted to begin by thanking the mayor, city administrator, budget director, and chief financial officer for their hard work in completing their third budget, and thank them for another successful fiscal year. The city's mandate reserves increased by more than $180 million, which is close to the goal of having 60 days of operating costs in the reserve. This year's budget is an increase of 3.4% from the previous year. Every year, our budget is a reflection of emerging needs and shifting priorities while trying to establish a healthy financial future. But more importantly, the budget is a statement of our priorities and is a reflection of who and what we value as a city. We live in a city every day where people of war, they confront the reality that we feel less valued. The data is crystal clear. Incomes are falling for already low-income households. D.C.'s poorest family among the poorest in major cities. Income inequality in D.C. has remained one of the highest among large U.S. cities for nearly a decade. And we have increased rates of homelessness and housing insecurities as a result of the housing crisis facing our city. While at the same time, D.C.'s high-income households are among the wealthiest in the nation, our city has had record surpluses and revenues. When we think about the achievement gap between blacks and whites in the city, the difference between Ward 8 and the rest of the city is in mortality rates, in access to health care, in levels of wealth, and in child poverty rate. We can see that there is a value gap where some areas of people are more valued than others. This is why we speak about the need for not just equality, but equity. Opportunity is not equal across the city right now, and it has not been for generations. Therefore, our budget and our resources distribution should reflect this reality by making substantial investments in improving the life and outcomes of those east of the Anacostia River. With that being said, I would like to thank Mayor Bowser for her consideration for some of the needs of Ward 8 residents in the budget. This budget takes important steps in addressing the need of people in Ward 8, such as an infrastructure academy at St. Elizabeth East. The funding of recommended options for TANF working groups ensure that families continue to access to benefits. The expansion of summer youth employment program and inclusion of $10 million to implement recommendations for the housing preservation strike force. Over $100 million for the development of St. Elizabeth's and expansion of funding for child care. While the aforementioned efforts are commendable, the budget as present is not sufficient to meet the needs of the people in Ward 8 and other wards like Ward 8. The budget does not go far enough to make a critical investment needed to destruct the systems of oppression and is a sense that our system has symptoms of decades of underinvestment in areas that need it the most. Only then will the city and its most vulnerable residents can be on the path of inclusive prosperity. A cup that is almost empty, filled with a few drops of hope, is a neglected cup still feeling hopeless. We simply need a strategic plan and a vision and courage it takes for those mothers who wake up every morning looking for resources and help to help grow their families and help their children go to better schools so they can have a better life than they themselves had. Particularly, this budget must do more to address the need of quality grocery and food options in Ward 8 and east of the river. It must do more to address the recreation needs of Ward 8 that has the greatest number of youth anywhere in Washington, D.C. It must do more to support entrepreneurs east of the river, and it must do more to ensure that our most challenged schools receive the funding that they need. To be honest, I'm simply tired of the nights of going uptown to hospitals from those suffering from gunshots and stab wounds. Simply put, the poor are getting poorer while cranes are in the sky and we are growing by leaps and bounds. I look forward to working with the executive branch of the government and the council and my council colleagues to reconcile this budget to ensure that we are being strategic, creative, and compassionate about the needs of the citizens of Ward 8, which are among the most pressing and critical needs the district face. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember White. Councilmember Vince Gray.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. As you know, and good morning to Mayor and to the City Administrator and to the Chief Financial Officer and other, and those who are here this morning as a part of this discussion. I think most people know I've been on both sides of the dais now for this budget briefing. And I certainly respect the work that it takes to produce an executive budget. So I'm not going to be somebody who sits on the dais and throws stones just for the sake of it. However, after having read most of this budget, I can't reconcile the budget's title, and that is, and I quote, DC Values in Action, a Roadmap to Inclusive Prosperity, unquote, with the actions that are proposed in the budget. A budget is supposed to be a policy document that reflects the citizens' priorities. But unfortunately, this budget doesn't represent D.C. values, in my opinion. Residents in D.C. Value education, safe communities, and a health care system that is accessible and serves everyone. The district's economy has continued its upward trajectory these last 2 years, and about that we are excited. Yet, I fear that so much opportunity has been lost. For example, we spent so much money on costly errors, such as $40 million for a single snowstorm, policies in homeless services that have drastically increased the numbers of families living in motels and overran the Department of Human Services budget, and a general feeling that we're spending lots of money on certain areas without a real plan or vision about how actually to deliver the results. There was, as we know, $413.9 million in new unallocated revenue that was certified by the CFO in fiscal years 17 and 18, which was not allocated for any other purposes. I recommended a few weeks ago that a good portion of this money be used to cover anticipated federal reductions in health care or other federally funded programs, all of which still looms large before us. Not only was that not done, but I'm deeply concerned that this budget falls short of adequately funding core functions of our government. It doesn't fully invest, in my opinion, in educating our children. It doesn't invest in keeping our neighborhoods safe, and it doesn't do anything to improve health access and outcomes for residents living on the east end of the city. I was thrilled to be on the front end of education reform back in 2007. The now decade-long movement for education reform in our schools, which was increasing student enrollment and test scores in both our traditional DC public schools and our public charter schools, has been stuck in neutral these last 2 years. And I'm concerned this budget may put school reform in reverse. Only once since the district emerged from the control period has public education not received an adjustment to the per student funding formula. It happened in fiscal year 16, and now we're seeing somewhat this disinvestment in our students for the second time in 3 years. We, of course, lost Kaya Henderson, who was the chancellor. We lost Lisa Ruder. We lost Abby Smith and Nathaniel Beers, who collectively, in my opinion, were the driving forces behind the vision for education reform in our government agencies. It is not possible for any district parents to look at this budget for our public schools and say that it invests fully in our children or conclude that it is sustainably balanced in a real way. I'm also deeply concerned that this budget accelerates the 3-year pattern of disinvesting in our police department. After 4 years of the lowest homicide rates in decades, 2015 saw a 54% increase in homicides. Violent crime and homicides have remained at levels alarmingly higher than the previous 4 years. The proposed fiscal year 18 budget cuts the baseline budget for MPD by $15.3 million in the middle of a public safety crisis in certain neighborhoods of the city, with Ward 7 arguably hit the hardest by the surge in violence. We needed at least $60 million per year more added to the MPD personnel budget to be able to include the retention incentives, base salary increases, mid-career pay dip right-sizing, hiring bonuses, and cadet recruiting program expansion that is needed just to get the force back up to 4,000 officers, much less the 4,200 that Chief Lanier and the late Paul Quander had recommended. This extraordinary $15.3 million cut now puts us over $75 million off where we need to be at MPD. We know policing alone doesn't solve crime. I've spent much of my career looking for alternatives to that, so let me make that absolutely clear, abundantly clear again. However, rather than fully fund the NEAR Act as drafted and enacted, this budget proposes an approach which merely diverts programs that are already doing other things without fully explaining how that is even a plausible strategy. So we're neither deterring crime nor are we solving its root causes. This budget also does nothing to develop a real healthcare system on the east end of the District of Columbia. The mayor's budget includes an increase for the existing United Medical Center that is structured in a drawn out year-to-year fashion that does not mirror any construction schedule for a new hospital, nor is it adequate to fund a new hospital. So one would presume the investments must be for the half century old existing facility that the mayor's own healthcare finance director testified last month should receive no new capital investments. This budget, as proposed, ensures that the east end of the District of Columbia by fiscal year 23, we will have moved no further along with creating a new healthcare system and a broad, appropriate healthcare system on the east end of the city. And that is grossly unfair to a quarter of the city's population that resides on the city's east end. Based on all of these deeply concerning shortcomings, I cannot connect the actions in this budget to the verbiage of its theme. This budget is not a roadmap to inclusive prosperity, in my opinion. It is a path that leads to nowhere. Creating inclusive prosperity is about educating our children and adults. It is about providing real high-quality infant and toddler care opportunities. It is about using our tax code and economic development agencies to create equal access to jobs, healthy food, and affordable retail stores in all of our neighborhoods in the city. In short, it is a theme in search of a vision. I look forward to working with Chairman Mendelson and my other 11 colleagues on the council to see what can be done to amend this budget to configure the kinds of meaningful investments that allow fiscal year 18 to realize the aspirations set out in its title. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilmember. Councilmember Nadeau.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I want to thank Mayor Bowser, as well as her team, including City Administrator Rashad Young, Budget Director Matt Brown, and CFO Jeff DeWitt for this briefing on the proposed fiscal year 2018 budget. Congratulations to you all. There are several items I am very pleased about as both the chair for the Committee on Human Services as well as the council member for Ward 1. I'd like to start off by thanking you for funding the express bus route along the 14th Street corridor that will further address our travel challenges faced by many commuters in the district. It has broad support among residents of Ward 1, and I know the neighboring wards that it serves as well, and this will most certainly help ease chronic congestion and provide a more efficient bus service. I was also pleased to learn that the ward can count on funding for the Lower Georgia Avenue Main Street. The additional resources provided by a Main Street program will help support our existing small businesses and improve the corridor, all the while we are further investing in the redevelopment of Park Morton and other resources in the area. And funding for a much-needed field remediation at LaJoy Park will help unlock the potential of that park for the entire community. As chair of the Human Services Committee, I'm pleased to see, Mayor, that you too are prioritizing TANF reform. I introduced a bill this week regarding TANF, the TANF Child Benefit Protection Amendment Act, that would eliminate time limits, ensure that children always receive benefits, and secure the opportunity for parents to earn additional benefits by continued engagement and participation in the program. And this bill is scheduled for a hearing later this month. And in reviewing the proposed TANF subtitle in your budget, Mayor, I see we are aligned in several critical areas. As we move through the budget process here at the Council, I look forward to working closely with my colleagues to guarantee that recipients are not beholden to arbitrary timelines and that children are never punished for parental inaction. Making homelessness rare, brief, and non-recurring remains a priority for me as well. And I look forward to working with your team and my colleagues to ensure that we have adequate funding in our local rent supplement program, our permanent supportive housing, our targeted affordable housing, all the while working with landlords across the district to ensure our residents who receive these benefits can easily find a place to call home. I also want to thank you for further investments in the continuum of care, as well as the ACE and PASS programs, which we know are tremendously successful and help our youth stay on a safe path. Once again, thank you, Mayor, for presenting your FY18 budget to us this morning. I hope to build upon this blueprint over the next couple of months with you and with my colleagues. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilmember Nadeau. Councilmember Bonds?
Thank you, Chairman, and good morning to Mayor Bowser, City Administrator, Chief Financial Officer, and the budget director, and all the other top administrators that are with us this morning. And I want to say many thanks for yet another balanced budget and robust revenues. Thank you so much. Our city will continue to grow, even with our concerns about the metro. We will continue to grow. And congratulations on your success yet another year. I believe that your budget contains many good and strong elements. And there are some things that each of us here would like more of, But that's the way it is when we're in the candy store, and we recognize that. I want to make some brief comments about the FY18 budget and highlight some issues that I will be taking a closer look at over the next month. In the last 5 years, the district has grown by about 10%, or 60,000 residents. These new residents have higher incomes and are driving up revenue from sales taxes, but all residents are faced with higher housing costs, much more so than ever before. As the chair of the Housing Committee, I support your continued effort at funding the Housing Production Trust Fund at $100 million. However, of course, I believe this floor can be increased, but at a minimum, $100 million is necessary so that the district can continue to support housing projects that serve its lower income residents throughout the city. In addition to the Housing Production Trust Fund, I look forward to examining the plan moving forward for new communities. It is very important to our public housing communities that these sites be completed as soon as possible and with an eye to the future while we take care of the needs of the present. I expect that the new developments will be of high quality and that the promises the city has made to residents will be kept. As the city, we must take all the step forward together and ensure that this economic resurgence that we are witnessing is far-reaching and inclusive. The tenant-based vouchers within the Housing Authority subsidy, again, it's positive. However, once again this year, the increase is earmarked for the homeless continuum of care. Like my colleagues, I am committed to the Homewood DC plan and to seeing it through on time. But I believe we must also begin to think once again about the many people who have been on the wait list for public housing in the district for many years, as well as the longstanding low-income residents that have waited patiently for affordable housing. Housing should not be an either-or proposition for residents. I am also supportive of the budget for the Office of Tenant Advocate. The OTA budget does critical work when they provide legal services to tenants, educate tenants about their rights and rental housing matters, provide financial assistance to displaced tenants in certain emergency housing situations, and generally advocating for the rights of district renters. This budget is very responsive to those needs. We are also would like to consider whether or not the Office of Tenant Advocate might be a good fit for assisting homeowners in condos, cooperatives, and homeowner associations that are frequently confronted with collective problems of residency in group settings. I'm also happy to see that the FY18 budget proposal appears to be supportive of our seniors. When I say appears, I have to say appears, because as seniors, as we all grow older, we want more and more, and we have more and more needs. So the Office on Aging has received a much needed 10% bump in funding to address the growing needs of its growing population. I hope that the office is funded at a level that it can expand its senior centers programming and communication outreach, both stated areas of need in the 2016 special needs assessment. Many thanks in particular for continuing support and capital dollars that might be used for enlarging at least one or two of the wellness centers. Mayor, I also applaud your efforts to support our public safety agencies. However, I will be closely examining whether MPD is able to recruit and hire officers at a rate that keeps up with the retirement bubble and at the same time keeps our neighborhoods safe. I would like to see more emphasis and dollars focused on community policing and interdiction of guns and synthetic drugs. Also, to be sure that the FEMS, FEMS, and OUC are given the resources and proper staffing to carry out their mission of delivering medical care throughout the community. With respect to education, I'm very glad that last year's $5.2 million increase for the University of the District of Columbia will now be reoccurring. I understand that UDC is once again creating new educational programs and even attracting valedictorians. University's president has put it this way. UDC provides three doors to higher education with their workforce training program that is free for residents, associate degree programs, and bachelor's degree programs, all of which lead to further doors of opportunity. And I believe that we're going to have a public university that will really commit itself and help become very special to our community and is certainly needed. Having a robust public higher education system in the district will likely motivate and propel many of our local K through 12 students to seek higher achievement at that level as well. I also applaud the continued increase in the uniform per student funding formula for our public school students. While I support even more, the 1.5 increase you are recommending can mean up to roughly an additional $200 per student, depending on the grade level. The $14 million increase in OSSE's early learning budget is also much needed as well and welcome. I know that the bigger Council providers Rounds. Will be lining.
Without objection.
Thank you so much. Up. Okay. While I know that the bigger providers will be lining up for license and grants, I do hope that we will see more smaller neighborhood-based providers opening up as well. I believe that child care is a necessity in our growing and thriving community, and would like to see more emphasis put on it. I look forward to hearing from you, the mayor, and the senior officers of the government about the difficult decisions that you had to make with the agencies and how you plan to help us understand that this budget is the budget that we should pass here at the council. So I thank you, Chairman.
Thank you, Councilmember Bonds. Councilmember Che.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and good morning, everybody. Special thanks to the mayor. I know how difficult this must be to put together this budget. Our preliminary look at the budget is that overall it's sound and a good budget. It provides, you know, for the needs of our residents in many areas, housing, transportation, public safety, education, programs aimed at improving the lives of all of our residents. And at the same time, I'm very pleased that you've decided to maintain the requirements or the follow-on for the 2014 Tax Commission recommendations, which was designed to make our tax code more progressive, make it more competitive. It's a sweeping change in our tax code, with taxes lowering for just about everybody, and most particularly for people in the middle class and people of low income. It makes us more competitive, it makes it more livable for people to be in the city, and so I'm pleased that we were able to carry that forward. Necessarily, as you know, because you were on this side, we will be looking at all of the measures that are here or funded or not funded. And we will have questions, and we will have our own suggestions about how things might better be done. For example, you know, from the big ticket items to perhaps more specific ones, the undertaking of even more debt is worrisome. I think Councilmember Evans has mentioned that. But even on the micro level, some of the things that we've looked at, I'm concerned about how we're allocating some of our school funding. It looks as though we're cutting some resources for pre-K in Ward 3 schools as a way of responding to overcrowding, and that's really backward. But I just mentioned that as one item. I do want to, again, though, congratulate you on what is overall a sound and good budget, and I look forward to the council's opportunity to have our influence. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Councilmember Che. Councilmember Silverman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and good morning. Good morning, Mayor Bowser. Good morning,
to your team, and congratulations on completing your third budget. Certainly, as you mentioned in your State of the District address, our city is growing and thriving, and that's a great thing. Our population continues to increase, personal incomes continue to go up in the aggregate, and our revenues are higher than ever. But once again, too many people in our city are feeling left behind and not sharing in the wider prosperity. Now, while test scores are rising at our public schools, we must continue to ensure that our schools are engines for social mobility. And the cost of housing, the high cost of housing, is pushing more and more of our residents of all income levels out of the city. And this is very concerning. I just want to touch upon a few items in your budget. Let me start with housing. I am really pleased to see the additional $10 million in the Housing Production Trust Fund for Preservation, which was a recommendation of the Housing Preservation Strike Force. And I think this can be a very effective tool and a cost-effective tool to preserve affordable housing in our city. I hope that as part of that effort, the preservation agency is created as well, since I do think we need a coordinating effort to use that money wisely. I also am really glad to see that there's an increase of inspectors in the Department of Consumer and Regulatory Affairs. These resources are needed, certainly needed, to put more manpower behind our housing inspections, to make sure that we have safe housing in our city. And I'm also happy to see there's an increase in our vacant and blighted property inspectors, which certainly is an effort to encourage owners to turn these properties back into productive use and make them an asset to our neighborhoods. I am also happy, as Councilmember Nadeau mentioned, to see comprehensive TANF legislation in this budget and funding to back it up. There are a few places that I hope that we can work together, as well as work with my council colleagues on. As the chair of the Labor and Workforce Development Committee, childcare, I think, is an incredible obstacle for many of our families. Our low-income families, but you know, moderate and some fairly well-to-do families as well. We just don't have enough childcare, and it's too expensive. So I was very glad to see your investment in new incentives to increase the supply of childcare in the district. But I do hope we can go further and work to increase the subsidy amount in, for our childcare vouchers. The current subsidy just isn't enough to meet the actual cost of childcare in the district, which means that many childcare centers simply won't accept the vouchers. And it puts the centers that do in somewhat of a financial bind. So I hope we can work together to find additional resources, especially for our working families, to make sure that they have access to affordable childcare. Another place I hope we can work together on is with our adult learners. Once again, a big workforce issue. We spend more than $80 million a year on adult education programs, but many residents can't take advantage of them simply because they can't afford to get to them. And actually, I think that number came out of a study done by the deputy mayor, who did very helpful report to highlight this issue. So I hope we can find what I think is a relatively modest amount of money to expand what has been, I think, a great initiative of yours, the Kids Ride Free program, so that it includes our adult learners. Finally, in my remaining time, I just want to emphasize the importance of funding our affordable housing programs, especially to make sure we're maximizing the production of our lowest income units through the Housing Production Trust Fund. I am concerned that we don't have the necessary resources to match the need we're seeing both in affordable housing and in our homelessness budget. I look forward to your presentation. I do have some questions about your new infrastructure program, which I'm very interested to learn a lot about, and I think can be a real asset to our workforce development system. So thank you very much, Mayor. I look forward to your presentation, and thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilmember Silverman. Councilmember Allen.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It's still morning, so good morning, Madam Mayor, and to your entire team, and of course, a thank you and congratulations to everybody who put in and logged a few hours to put this budget together. And even if I don't agree with every aspect of it, I respect and appreciate all the hard work that goes into it by your entire team, so thank you very much. I do want to note, I think that you have put forward a very strong public safety budget. This comes before us. I think you've made significant investments that were long overdue in our fleet and our infrastructure in particular, MPD, Fire and EMS, and OUC. I really like that you've also committed to various tools for recruiting and retaining the best in our first responders, which is another top priority for our committee on judiciary and public safety. You've also committed to funding for victim services, which, as we know, is incredibly critical to making sure that we are supporting our communities as well as improving public safety. So I really want to commend you and your entire team for helping shore up a lot of those significant investments that are needed in these agencies, and I look forward to working with you and your team as we move through the committee process. I also just want to briefly note a couple other significant investments that I think are very wise, and I'm very glad to see the continued support of Homeward DC. I'm very proud that that is a step our city is taking, as well as I'm very proud of Ward 6 for the work that they did to come around the Ward 6 site and in full support of that. I'm glad to see the investment that you're making in the Safe at Home initiative, which is something that Councilmember Bonds and I, partnering with yourself, have been very supportive of. I think makes meaningful investments for our seniors and older residents to be able to stay in their homes with very modest investments in home modifications. Your child care investment, I think, is a very important thing, much needed for our city and for our families. I appreciate that you're investing in the Made in DC program and funding that. I think that's a great way that we help support our entrepreneurs and small businesses here. The affordable housing investments, the additional money and a lot of the preservation, much, much needed. And the support for WMATA, of course, without saying how important and how critical that funding is for the district. And I hope it will also be the peer pressure that we need. And I appreciate your comments at your State of the District address to try to help put pressure on our partners and neighbors to the east and the west to do what they need to do. A couple of things where I want to continue work because I don't think that we are where we need to be. And that has to do with some of the school modernization in Ward 6. 2 years ago, several Ward 6 schools were moved, either slid back several years or moved off the capital improvement plan altogether. I'm glad to see that there's an effort to get Jefferson completed 1 year earlier than where it was in the capital improvement plan, but that's still after a significant delay of where it should have been. I want to continue working to try to put Jefferson up as quickly as possible. It's incredibly important, I think, for the Jefferson Middle School community as well as for all the elementary school communities that feed into that. I was also disappointed that the Capitol Hill Montessori at Logan, which is a citywide school, but it's located in Ward 6, has planning dollars, but that still is not fully into the capital improvement plan. And that is a school that runs pre-K all the way through 8 and is a middle school and is not fully in the capital improvement plan. I'm concerned about the reduction to the circulator. I want to help understand a little bit more about where that plan is, but the city has previously made a commitment to returning the circulator to Southwest, not just for the wharf, but obviously for the soccer stadium. And I'm concerned about what that reduction may mean for us living up to that commitment for the circulator to be returning back to Southwest. And then an item that it's a pet issue for me, but it's something I care a lot about. I was disappointed that the book budget for our DC Public Library system is reduced. I think it's critically important that we've got those resources to make sure that our books, both in a physical copy and electronic copy, are available throughout our library branches. And that's something that's just very important to me and we'll continue to work on. But I don't need to take the full time of my, we've done a lot of talking up here for opening statements. I know you've got a presentation to get to, we've got a lot of questions to go. So I don't have anything further to add at this point. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Councilmember Allen. Councilmember McDuffie.
Good morning, Madam Mayor and team. I appreciate you all being here this morning. Look forward to an engaging conversation this morning about the budget that you presented. I don't plan to take up all of my time, but I do have a couple of things that I'd like to mention in my opening, and I will have some questions once we get to our rounds. I want to compliment you on submitting, again, another balanced budget, which I think is a testament to the strength of the district overall, the policies that the government has come together to work on collaboratively. And quite frankly, I think a testament to our exercise of restraint and how we spend and the consideration that we give to the policies that are important to the residents in the District of Columbia. That said, there are some overarching questions that I have regarding the budget and some specific to Ward 5. In the interest of time, I'm just going to list off a few that I'd like to highlight. I'm concerned about the myriad of new funds that are being created in the budget proposal. There are many under, just for example, the Department of Environment. There's several being created for moving violations, I think, non-moving violations, automated traffic enforcement tickets, pedestrian fines, and it seems the list goes on. Creating several new funds really concerns me because I think it creates a more complicated and less transparent budget. And I'd like to hear your thoughts behind the decision to do that. I do want to thank you for advancing Lamon Riggs Library and the Capital Improvement Plan. I think we met last month and talked about that, and we both were on the same page recognizing that as only one of the two libraries that we have in Ward 5, Lamon Riggs really is sorely in need of renovations. And I think the residents of Lamon Riggs and North Michigan Park agree wholeheartedly with that. I also want to thank you for committing to the renovation of Fort Lincoln Park and the expansion of Theodore Hagen's Cultural Center. I've had a lot of conversations with residents of Fort Lincoln, Dakota Crossing, and the villages, and we really need to modernize that to meet the needs of a growing neighborhood and population and community in that part of Ward 5. On its face, it appears that the funds remain available for the acquisition of the W Street Trash Transfer Station site, and I hope that there won't be any snags in trying to push that process forward. And something that we, I think, gave the authority to the executive back in 2014 to exercise eminent domain, and I would really like to see that process move forward to have the trash transfer station finally either acquired or we exercise eminent domain and get rid of the trash transfer station site from Brentwood Road and get rid of the stench that accompanies the trash transfer station. I would like to hear about your thoughts, Madam Mayor, on how this budget hits the goals of the NEAR Act, which was passed unanimously by this council in 2015 and went into law last year. And I see that it appears you're asking to change the name of the Office of Neighborhood Safety and Engagement. So I'd like to hear your thoughts behind that and how you think that approach is going to meet the goals of taking a health-based approach to crime prevention in the District of Columbia. And finally, I think I'm really concerned about the lack of investment in Ward 5 DCPS facilities. With only about $3.6 million in a six-year CIP, I think that it's an area where, I know that it's an area where we need to see more equity in Ward 5, and I hope to work with my colleagues to try to address that. I look forward to hearing from you this morning and working towards a more detailed analysis of the proposed budget and working with my colleagues in the days and months to come to make sure this budget reflects the needs and concerns and wants of the residents of the District of Columbia. So again, I thank you and your team, as well as the CFO and his team for the work that's been put into this process. And thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilmember McDuffie. Well, Mayor Bowser, I guess for starters, I want to thank you for sitting through an hour of opening statements. The turn is now yours. I think we hear from you, and then we hear from Mr. DeWitt, and then there'll yes. be one round of questions.
Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning, Mr. Chairman, and good morning, council members, and a pleasant morning also to the residents of Washington, D.C., who I'm sure will watch at some point, if not now, on Channel 13 and Channel 16. I'm pleased today to testify on my administration's fiscal FY 2018 budget. More than 2 years ago, Mr. Chairman, the residents of Washington, D.C. trusted me with their votes to lead our great city based on my commitment to develop inclusive prosperity, to fight for workers, and to invest in families. For the third year in a row, I held a series of budget engagement forums before we formulated the budget, and hundreds of residents from across Washington, D.C. attended them. These forums gave me the opportunity to hear directly from residents about what is important to them and how their government should spend their tax dollars. They prioritize education, affordable housing, and the human services. So, Mr. Chairman, I've sent to the council for consideration a budget that serves to promote and defend our DC values as we work to attain inclusive prosperity for all Washingtonians. The FY18 budget totals $13.8 billion, including $7.6 billion in local funds. It completes the plan developed by the Tax Review Commission, chaired by former Mayor Tony Williams and the DC Fiscal Policy Institute's Ed Lazier. That plan was adopted by the council to lower the tax burden on individuals, families, and businesses in the district. By allowing for the full implementation of these triggers in the FY18 budget, we can capitalize on the district's recent economic prosperity to give relief to district taxpayers. Implementation of these triggers will provide $60 million in relief for district residents the council has categorized as low or moderate income. $12 million in relief will benefit higher income district residents, and $28 million in relief will benefit district-based businesses, including DC small businesses. This budget invests $1.2 billion in capital projects in FY 2018 and $6.6 billion over the life of the six-year capital plan. What I present today, Mr. Chairman, is the district's 22nd balanced budget. I should also note that last month marked the 20th year of clean audits for the District of Columbia and the second consecutive year of no yellow book findings. That means no material weaknesses in our procurement, hiring, payment, or any other critical system of our government. This is a good government gold standard for which my administration is very proud. And that means that we've proven ourselves to be exemplary stewards of our government's resources. That means making investments that make our city better and make our families stronger. Here are just a few. We've invested $1.5 billion, the largest investment in public education in the district's history, an increase of $105 million or 7.1% over last year's budget. $1.3 billion over the next 6 years for the continued modernization of our traditional elementary, middle, and public high schools. A 2.2% increase in the per pupil facilities allotment for public charter schools to have safe, welcoming learning environments across the district. $100 million to the Housing Production Trust Fund, as promised and as done in my last two budgets. We've created a new $10 million dedicated solely to a housing preservation fund, leveraging also private investments, which should yield tens of millions of dollars more in investments in our preservation efforts. Also, $356 million for local roads and bridge improvements, sidewalk and curb upgrades, alley maintenance and construction, and getting these vital resources to a state of good repair. We've also included $276 million for recreation centers, swimming pools, and park improvements. We've added $3 million for Safe at Home to continue helping older residents with home improvements to make aging in place possible. We've also added $5.2 million to continue Transport DC, Senior Rides, the Senior Fit and Well program, and additional funding for senior villages. We've included $180 million for United Medical Center, understanding that there will be a needed upgrades to the current facility, but also recognizing that we have to find a hospital partner, and we have to make sure that we are ensuring a system of care to replace the United Medical Center with a new facility. We are also adding $430 million to fully fund the district's portion of the WMATA's operating budget, including $2 million to expand the 59 Limited Express bus on 14th Street and improve bus service on the W4 route serving Ward 7 and 8. We have also added $16.75 million to build the new District of Columbia Infrastructure Academy on the St. Elizabeth's campus in Ward 8. This new academy will serve as a hub for workforce development and on-the-job training and activities related to the infrastructure industry, including the utility, energy efficiency, transportation, and logistics sectors. For this project, we will leverage an additional $5 million from the negotiated utility merger settlement. We've added $11.7 million to support MPD recruitment, retention, and civilianization efforts, including housing, help, and tuition forgiveness. We've included $87.7 million for firefighting apparatus and ambulances, which will help ensure that we have fire engines and ambulances that are available for our growing need. Let me just briefly touch base on a few initiatives funded in this budget. I'll start with the My Child Care DC pilot. I challenged my team to design a program to incentivize the creation of 1,300 more infant and toddler child care opportunities across DC over the next 3 years. Private providers tell us that the cost of meeting the robust early childhood regulations are high. Space and build-out expenses are challenging, and training and maintaining high-quality staff is increasingly difficult. We will make DC government-owned or controlled space available as part of the My Child Care DC pilot initiative. I look forward to working with DC families to get these important ideas in place. We will expand access to child care, and that is something that is very important for the growth of our city. We will invest $15 million to fund our FY18 commitment to this new program. On a related note, I know that we've spent the better part of 2 years talking about universal paid leave, and we share the DC value that families should have the time they need to take care of a loved one. Now, we may not agree on the best way to get there, but I am encouraged that our dialogue continues. My hope is that the path forward will not jeopardize our expanding pool of jobs or stunt the growth of our successful small businesses. We look forward to the council's June hearing on the two new paid leave bills proposed by council members Che, Gray, and Evans. On education, I am also proud that we're making the single largest investment in public education in the district's history by investing $1.5 billion, an increase of 7.1% over last year's budget. This includes a 1.5% increase to the uniform per student funding formula and a 2.2% increase to public charter schools in the public charter school facility allotment, which we know provides schools with the resources they need to achieve their mission. I know that there have been some questions about why we increased the per pupil formula by 1.5% instead of by 2%. So let me be clear, we have made no cuts to public education spending, but instead we have increased by 1.5%. We are also committed to reaching a new agreement with our teachers in the upcoming year, and we expect the need to adjust the per pupil formula to accommodate those increased staffing investments. I know the call for the additional 0.5% increase, which amounts to about $7 million per year, or something around $50 per student, are well-intentioned, but they do not account for what we expect to be still larger education investments in the future. Furthermore, we will invest an additional $1.3 billion over the six-year capital plan for school modernization projects. With this commitment, we will have renovated or modernized 100 out of 111 school buildings by 2023. That's 90% of our school buildings. Our plan for school modernizations is completely aligned with the council's PACE prioritization, which is a ranking of priorities for modernization, and allows us to continue to move forward. Let me highlight some of the capital investments in this budget for schools. We invested an additional $15 million in Morey Elementary School to account for increased enrollment, and an additional budget was also included for Bancroft and Hyde Addison to address construction issues encountered. We also aligned the Jefferson Middle School with all other modernizations. Instead of spreading that funding over 4 years, we're able to complete Jefferson 1 year earlier and spread that funding over only 3 years. We allocated planning money for schools not currently in the plan, and you'll find that in the last year of the capital improvements plan. And we also allocated money to fund recommendations that will flow from the master facility plan related to overcrowding. You'll also find that in the final year of the plan. This means that we will have a roadmap when we have the completed master facilities plan for planning for all the schools included with planning dollars, but also for the remaining 35 phase one schools. Our new, let me talk about economic opportunity. Our new five-year economic development strategy takes the unequal distribution of benefits from a robust economy head-on and aims for inclusive prosperity. The strategy sets as a goal increasing the economic prosperity of African Americans in Washington, specifically by reducing double-digit unemployment among African Americans. While the unemployment rate has declined in the district, it is still disproportionately high among people of color, people who live in Ward 7 and 8, and those without a high school diploma. We see a geographic divide in our city that is greater than distance. Unemployment in Ward 3 is at 4.2%, and in Ward 8 is 12.5%. The good news is that in the last 2 years, Ward 8 unemployment has been reduced from over 16% to 12%, but that's still staggeringly high. Last week, I announced that we would create the District of Columbia Infrastructure Academy. We will partner with UDC, WMATA, DC Water, leading infrastructure companies like Washington Gas and Pepco, along with our labor unions and trade associations to give our residents training that is not connected to it, that is going to connect our training with the jobs that are available in the district. We secured seed money in our recent merger settlement discussion, and now we will make the academy a significant spoke in our portfolio of initiatives to reduce African American unemployment. We're also focusing on infrastructure and getting our local roads to a state of good repair. DDOT estimates our main roads are in pretty good shape with only 7% in poor condition. We estimate that about 32% of our local roads, however, get a poor rating. Our residential roads suffer from a lack of consistent funding and regularly scheduled maintenance. With this budget, we will prioritize improvements on all the roads that have a poor rating in the next 5 years. We will take lessons learned from Alleypalooza, where we've improved more than 200 alleys in 2 years. We will be smart about coordination with planned developments and utility repairs. We will separate street and sidewalk and curb projects where it makes sense, and we will commit to using sustainable building practices and materials. We'll continue investments to make our city safer for bikers and pedestrians with new bike lanes, upgraded traffic signals, an extension of the Anacostia Riverwalk Trail, and much improved Metropolitan Branch Trail. In the area of affordable housing, we have made unprecedented commitments. As we grow our economy, we want to ensure that residents, whether they've been here, as I like to say, for 5 minutes or for five generations, can afford to live in Washington, D.C. We are forging a path to make homelessness rare, brief, and non-recurring in our city. This budget continues key investments in Homeward, D.C., and efforts to reform our homeless services system overall, including the transformation of our continuum of care contract and through investments to replace DC General with a system of smaller, more dignified facilities across the city to ensure that we can close DC General once and for all by 2018. But we must do more to protect and preserve affordable housing. Together, we have committed $100 million annually to the Housing Production Trust Fund in the last two budgets. This budget will be the third one where we realize this commitment, but I want it to be clear, we're not just squirreling away this money, we are putting it to work. Today, I'm committing an additional $10 million dedicated solely to a preservation fund. This new fund is a recommendation that came out of our Housing Preservation Strike Force, and I want to thank Councilmember Silverman and Bonds for serving on that strike force. Next, let me turn to public safety. We will continue to make investments to create a safer, stronger DC. We are combating the expected retirement bubble at MPD with strategic investments in recruitment and retention. This budget will build on our successful retention programs, such as the Senior Police Officer Expansion Program. Our continued recruitment programs will double slots for DC residents in our cadet program. We will recruit and retain new officers in those early years when they are more easily and frequently wooed by competing jurisdictions with additional housing help and tuition forgiveness. We will continue to invest in activities that prevent crime as well. And I look forward to talking about how many of the NEAR Act activities are underway, and now we are focused on investing in mental health co-response to crime. Let me say a few things about fire and EMS. To better support our fire and EMS department and everything they do to keep us safe, we invested $12 million into that department. This is the single largest investment in EMS reform in the city's recent history. We can build on this progress by creating a nurse triage center at the 911 call center. Until recently, fire and EMS fleet staffing, training, and protocols have not kept up with the explosive population growth of our city. For the first time, a nurse at the 911 call center will make sure everyone who needs an ambulance gets one, and that those who do not are referred to insurance-provided transportation and community-based non-urgent providers. Our calls to 911 are wildly out of proportion to our population, which compromises emergency services for everyone. We can't wait any longer to fix this problem. Chairman Mendelson, I wanted to briefly highlight a few initiatives included in this budget. It, of course, includes more critical investments that allow my very talented team and our 33,000 employees to deliver for the residents of the district each and every day. Their activities, of course, include trash collection, snow removal, the distribution of driver's licenses, cybersecurity monitoring, hiring employees, and procuring goods and services, just to name a few. I want to say thank you to each of our employees for their dedicated service to me and the residents of the District of Columbia. But before I turn to your questions, I also wanted to make a point about the uncertainty of our times. It should be noted that because of our fiscal discipline and our investment in activities that have helped grow our city, we are better prepared than we could have ever imagined for this moment. It is true that we do not know what the final result of the actions of the President and Congress will be. I can tick off at least $1 billion worth of threats to federal investments in cities, eliminating vital EPA programs, eliminating arts funding, eliminating the community development block grants, repealing Obamacare, and attacking or revising the tax code that can have significant implications on how we invest in affordable housing. For this reason, I have submitted a provision in the Budget Support Act that would direct additional revenue over the revenue estimates upcoming into two funds, one for workforce investments and the second to address any federal cuts that go against our DC values. Chairman Mendelson and members of the council, that concludes my overview of the FY18 budget. And in closing, I want to thank the many residents of DC who came to forums, who stopped me in grocery stores, who talked to my agency directors, who send us emails, tweets, and calls to say thank you, but also to challenge us to continue continue to run the government in an open and transparent way and responsible way that delivers on our DC values. I also want to thank your teams who have worked with us to craft a budget that also reflects your priorities, and the members of the CFO's office and the CFO himself who have been very cooperative, professional, and responsive to helping us deliver this balanced budget.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Mr. DeWitt.
Good morning, Chairman Mendelson and members of the Committee of the Hall. I'm Jeffrey DeWitt, the Chief Financial Officer of the District of Columbia, and I'm pleased to appear to you today to testify on the fiscal 2018 proposed budget and financial plan. The fiscal year 2018 proposed budget includes $7.6 billion in local funds and $13.8 billion in gross funds. The Office of the Chief Financial Officer worked closely with the Mayor's executive team, Office of Budget and Finance staff, and agency program staff to produce a balanced budget and five-year financial plan that reflects the mayor's priorities, which she just discussed. As indicated in my certification letter contained in the budget books, I have certified that the FY 2018 budget and financial plan as proposed is balanced. In terms of the revenue outlook is predicated on continuing moderate growth in national economy and assumes similar growth in the district's economy with added jobs and residents over the period of the financial plan. Measures to constrain spending at the federal level are expected to be in effect during the financial plan. The prospects of further federal budget cuts is a source of economic uncertainty and risk, as the mayor just discussed, for the district's economy and finances. To account for this risk and uncertainty around the federal budget, the financial plan does assume that federal employment in the district will decline by modest amounts starting in fiscal year 2018. In terms of budget highlights, proposed FY 2018 gross fund budget grew at 3.4% over the approved FY 2017 budget. Revenues and other resources equal expenditures with a margin of at least $500,000 in each fiscal year of the financial plan period. It reflects more efficient debt structuring, use of special purpose revenue or O-type funds, use of the fixed commodity reserves, carryover funds from prior years, and policy initiatives that produce revenue throughout the financial plan period. One area I'd like to take a moment to clarify in reference to my certification letter is a line that talks about a new sales on digital products. This is really not a new tax. Rather, it's an initiative to clarify the existing administrative authority of the tax commissioner to ensure that taxes are paid on these products. The mayor's budget and financial plan does not make use of any federally or locally mandated reserves, which are important to maintain our high credit ratings. And federally and locally mandated reserves are approaching 60 days of cash reserves. Our credit rating is very important to ensure the capital program can be financed at the lowest possible cost in order to fund our large infrastructure needs, which the mayor just discussed. The proposed budget makes significant investments in infrastructure improvements, a total of $6.6 billion over the capital planning horizon. The majority of the budget, $4.1 billion, will be financed through the issuance of municipal bonds or debt. As I indicated previously, my office will work to ensure these debt service costs in the capital plan are structured as efficiently as possible to lessen the impact on the financial plan to the extent possible. Debt service within the capital improvement plan period remains below the 12% debt cap. That being said, the large bond funding does have an impact on future available resources. Approximately one-third of all future revenue growth must go to support the associated debt service for this large capital program. As a result, personnel, contract, and other operating costs the mayor had to go through and constrain well below the 3% growth rate throughout the financial plan, assuming the capital plan is implemented as scheduled. This constraint will also apply to any changes the council may make to the proposed budget unless modifications are made to the capital program. To provide an example of what we all deal with at a personal level, if you buy a larger home with a bigger mortgage or have a larger lease, a larger apartment with higher rent, that will constrain what you can spend on other things in your day-to-day budget. Careful monitoring of these costs as well as execution of the capital plan is required to ensure the financial plan remains balanced in all future years. The Office of the Chief Financial Officer is available to assist all of you and your staff with any questions or analysis you may have as you review the budget over the coming weeks. As I often say, we work for the mayor as she prepares the budget, and we work for you as you go to review it, and we will continue to honor that commitment as we have in the past. In conclusion, I want to sincerely thank the Mayor Bowser, City Administrator Rashad Young and his team, Matt Brown and his team of the Office of Budget and Planning, and the associates, CFOs, and all the agency staff throughout the district who've worked with us together to produce a balanced budget. I look forward to working with the council during the upcoming budget deliberations, and I thank you for your time for this testimony.
Thank you, and I believe you, those are the only two statements from the
yes.
folks at the table. So we'll be on 10-minute rounds. There'll be one round with the mayor at the table and then one round following that. In my opening remarks, I spoke about how the council, the OCFO, and the executive need to work together to achieve the CFO's recommendation of increasing PAYGO, that's pay-as-you-go, for capital needs by $325 million per year, so that all of the assets we just spent billions of dollars on stay in a state of good repair. I suggested that we look to carryover funds and revenue growth to meet this goal. Do you, Madam Mayor, have a plan, or what is your thinking at this point on how we would reach that goal?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I agree with you that the CFO has put us in a position, and I don't think many jurisdictions would be able to say the same, in purchasing a system, and that he's worked with our agencies to really determine the state of repair of most of the assets, if not all of the assets by now, of the District of Columbia. That includes our fleet, it includes our streets and roads, and it includes our public buildings. And so we have, and that's what has allowed him to lay out a roadmap of how we make the necessary investments in those assets. We are pleased that this budget grows over the year and the amount that we dedicated that we dedicate to pay as you go. And I do think that we will need to work together with the members of the council to get to what is not an insignificant amount every year to put to the side, $300 million. But I think that it is a goal that we must pursue.
Do you have any thoughts on how we get to it? Because that's $225 million on top of what we're now budgeting. How much PAYGO do we have budgeted?
I think we start at $48 million, and by the end of the plan, we're up to $121 million.
126.
And then we would be, Mr. DeWitt, we would be adding 325 to that?
That would be correct, yes.
So any thoughts how we find that?
Well, Mr. Chairman, I think we have a couple of capital conversations that we need to have. And I think that we have, and we'll be able to get there when we have to make additional capital commitments to Metro, because that's a big number that we can't accommodate with our current funding. I think that we'll hear throughout this morning a desire to speed up school modernizations. And we know that we have $1.5 billion. That is included in the Chief Financial Officer's analysis. But if we are to raise that additional kind of money to get there, we're going to have to talk about that as well.
Just to follow up, the mayor and I had a discussion about the analysis on the state of good repair, and you heard her mention they took a look at the roads to get the roads and the alleys up to that area. So that data is being used even within the pay-as-you-go amount that's in the budget to focus on something that is obvious that the data does show you, and that's streets. Particularly the secondary streets. So that pay-as-you-go is allocated to that data that comes out of that system to get the streets to a state of good repair.
Sure, but that speaks to the need. It doesn't speak to how much we have to come up with.
Correct.
Or how we're going to come up with that.
Correct.
Let me go from macro to micro. The budget increases DCRA's budget by 10% from $55.5 million to $61.2 million. Madam Mayor, where do you see that we're focusing this within DCRA? What, how does this investment improve the agency? What programs are being targeted to benefit? Just kind of overall, your intent.
Sure, our intent and the DC, there's a lot of growing demand for the services and permits and licenses that DCRA provides, but also for inspection. And we've heard a lot about this condition of vacant properties in our city, of nuisance properties in our city, and of what we might call occupied nuisance properties in our city. In any case, they are either private lots or structures where the standards for repair and the condition aren't up to our standards. So we have to give DCRA more firepower, if you will, in the form of inspectors to make sure that we are holding property owners accountable for the proper standards and conditions at their properties. And the city administrator would tell me the exact amount of that increase.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Mr. Chairman, for what we're doing in DCRA is about $1 million for business process improvements. That would be for things like predictive analytics on our proactive inspection program so that we have an algorithm that tells us where we should go and with what frequency. About $300,000 for additional housing inspectors and about $1.2 million for the nuisance abatement activities that the mayor spoke about. That includes roughly 10 FTEs to increase the frequency and the turnaround time of our abatement activities as well as inspections of nuisance abatement.
That's not the entirety of the increase, I don't
and
think.
And about $1 million is related to additional IT investments as well.
Okay. So improving processing, as in, as you said, predictive analytics for where to do inspections, some IT upgrades, and then focusing more on just being able to do inspections.
Yes. Housing inspection
that's
and
where
nuisance
you're seeing abatements. The emphasis.
I think we might and also have it as yes on permitting.
Thank you,
more staff on permitting.
Okay.
Processing permits.
This is more of a, I think, a request if you would get back with some information. The district dedicates significant resources every year to affordable housing, much more than the $100 million set aside annually for the Housing Production Trust Fund. We spend local funds at the Housing Authority. We spend local funds at the Department of Human Services and at the Department of Housing and Community Development, just to name a few. Do you have a breakdown of the total amount of funds the district dedicates annually to affordable housing? And if not, I'd like if you could pull that together. Do you have a breakdown?
Yeah. Mr. Chairman, we have taken a look at that, and I don't know that I would say we have an all-inclusive list today. But roughly $230 million on that order of magnitude includes housing programs, financing of affordable housing across a number of district agencies. We can share with you the data that we have and just give us an opportunity to make sure that that analysis is complete.
Okay, I'd appreciate that. So you'll get back to me with a...
We will.
A checked and double-checked list. But essentially, it's not just $100 million with the Housing Production Trust Fund. It's about... A quarter, $230 million. That's like $250 million that we're spending on affordable housing.
Yes, and the housing, we should note, the Housing Production Trust Fund, as you know, Mr. Chairman, and all the members who were here when it was created, has really been focused on the creation of new housing and the preservation of some existing units. Specifically, and then largely it has been used to support tenants who wish to purchase their properties. The HPTF law sets out the income bands that are also available. And many of our other programs are very targeted and often targeted by income.
Still on the Housing Production Trust Fund, but a different issue. The Housing Production Trust Fund is authorized to use up to 10% or $10 million of each year's $100 million allocation for administrative expenses. This year's Budget Support Act that you're proposing includes a subtitle that would allow the Department of Housing and Community Development to use an additional 5% of the Housing Production Trust Fund money. It rolls over from one year to the next for administrative costs. At the end of fiscal year 16, the Housing Production Trust Fund had a fund balance of approximately $250 million. So using that, this subtitle could allow an additional $12.5 million of fund balance to be used for administrative expenses, or a total of $22.5 million. So what is the rationale for increasing the administrative costs, the limit, increasing the limit, is that the right way to put it? Expanding the limit for administrative costs, which of course don't actually go to housing. And I guess related to that, I would ask, why does it cost so much money to get HPTF money out the door? But let's go with the expansion first.
Sure. So we have been very focused on the Housing Production Trust Fund and not just asking the council for the additional money, but making sure the money is going to projects and is being used efficiently. I think you know we were involved with the council's auditor for almost 2 years in an audit of the HPTF. She looked at quite a number of projects, most of which were not new projects to our administration, but were legacy projects in the Housing Production Trust Fund. And what was very clear is that the pipeline of projects, those things that are part of the carryover, require a lot of work and administration around making sure that they are compliant all the way from the time they apply to the time construction starts until they deliver, and even after delivery. We found the administration funds to be insufficient. So for the current year, we need those funds to administer the new proposals, get them underwritten, and get them started. But we also need administrative focus on those projects that are in the pipeline. CA has been very involved with Director Donaldson on this issue.
Mr. Chairman, just by way of context, the fund balance today is roughly $250 million. That is not the amount we expect to carry over in fiscal year 18. We expect the fund balance from 17 to 18 to be more on the order of magnitude of $70 million. And so it would be 5% of that number that would move into the fiscal year 18 budget. But to the mayor's point, there are a couple of things that are working here on the need for administrative dollars. It is the compliance and monitoring of existing projects, even those that predate the funding year that we are in. But there really has been the continuous work on those backlog of projects that we had to move through underwriting to loan closing. And the second issue, which is not related to HPTF, but impacts the need for local dollars, is the amount of federal funds that is in that agency. So there are two ways that that many staff, most staff, allocate their time, either to a federal project or to working on Housing Production Trust Fund. Those federal funds have caps and rules and requirements as to how much you can charge administrative overhead to those funds. And so to make sure that we stay in compliance with the federal guidelines for those federal funds, we've had to lessen the amount of administrative overhead we charge to federal accounts, while also we have the issue of working on the backlog and working on monitoring and compliance. Those things require an additional investment of local funds.
What's the cap on the federal?
It depends on what program that you're talking about. So CDBG has a cap. HOME has a different set of requirements and rules. We're happy to provide you what those caps and rules are.
Are they over 10%?
I'm happy to provide you what
they are.
All
right, if you would. Councilmember Robert White, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Thank you.
I want to, I guess, pick up now with the Housing Production Trust Fund. I agree with your analysis, Madam Mayor, that the auditor's report was helpful from a historical perspective, but not particularly helpful in the current state of the trust fund, which I think is moving much, much better than it has in the past.
Thank
the funds
you.
Seem to be getting obligated, and it seems to be meeting its purpose. And I do appreciate that you set a floor of $100 million annual investment in the trust fund. I was curious, though, about your proposal for separate funding in the housing, for housing preservation. Why could we not include that extra $10 million in the Housing Production Trust Fund, since my understanding is that the trust fund already supports both production and preservation?
Well, thank you, Council Member. We are going to task the Housing Preservation Fund with a focus on vulnerable units. And the Housing Preservation Strike Force spent, I think, 6 months talking about vulnerable units. And when I say that, these are units that we know in the next several years will face the expiration of affordability covenants. and we want to develop a strategy to attract private dollars to make those investments. So unlike the housing preservation, the HPTF, we want to try to leverage that $10 million in public money and attract private investment. And we want to target those units that are facing expiring tax credits, which may or may not fall within the guidelines of the HPTF.
Would the affordability levels change with this $10 million?
I don't, when you say, will it always be for people 80%, 60%, or 30% of the AMI or below? My guess is that it absolutely would be, because we have to, that's what makes it affordable. But I'm asking the team to come up with regulations and guidelines that would support our ability to be able to attract private investment and our ability to target expiring covenants.
Thank you. I also very much appreciate your investment in increasing child development slots by 1,300 seats in this budget. The need there is incredibly real and urgent. And so I wanted to begin here by getting your perspective on how we should balance the simultaneous need for more slots and for higher reimbursement rates for the existing slots. In my meetings with the Child Development Center operators, it's become apparent that the current business model for early childhood development is broken because the pay that teachers can expect to make is far too low to sustain the industry. It averages around $26,000 a year, while the cost, obviously, the parents is incredibly high. So I wonder what your thoughts are on how we strike that balance, how we meet this challenge.
Well, thank you, Council Member, and you are right to say that it's a complicated issue. And it's a complicated issue across our city. And we have done such a good job of attracting families and attracting three-year-olds to our public schools. It has become even more complicated for our providers. We see a number of things that need to happen. We need to make sure that the environment is conducive for private operators to start or expand and offer new slots across the city. And that's what the My Child Care DC pilot is focused on. We need to also help, and these grants will help people expand slots or start new slots, but it will also target the education requirements around early childhood education and help people advance through that education that's going to be necessary to work in our early childhood centers. I do think that we will continue to need to talk about how we increase rates in our subsidized slots. I know that a number of council members have talked to me about that. We also, what has been our focus on those slots over the last 2 years, is increasing quality. Not only do we want to increase pay, but we have to make sure that we're getting what our parents who are sending their children, they are getting what they expect there too. So we have had a real focus on improving on quality. I don't think currently have waiting lists in those subsidized spots. I don't want to confirm that's for every age level. So we're really focused right now on quality improvement.
Thank you. And while I'm very concerned with providers, I'm also concerned about parents who, like you, I'm sure, want to stay in the city. And I know this pain myself, as I have a child in a program. The average cost for an early childhood development program in D.C. is $1,800 per child a year. And many of our residents, particularly with the cost of living in D.C., can't afford this. So obviously another issue is that the market rate early childhood development slots are far outside the means of many of our families. Could you talk a little bit about what your budget would do to make these services more affordable or attainable for parents?
Well, what our budget does is focus on how to get more slots. And, you know, typically when there's more capacity, the costs go down. So we hope that will be the case here too. But even 1,300 council members, if we're successful in incentivizing that many new slots, it still won't be enough. We have 10,000 babies born here every year. I think think we have 8,000 slots and many, many fewer infant and toddler slots. So we have a lot of work to do. But you are right. We visited our early child care center on Wednesday, just yesterday. That is the federal model that we hope to emulate in D.C., where the federal sponsoring federal agencies support the space, the build-out of the space, and the rent. So that helps lower the operating cost for that location. So that's one way to work on it. Some people also think that we should look at local child care tax credits. So for families who are having that type of expense, that they would see some kind of benefit at the end of the year. That is something that we don't contemplate in this budget, but we're certainly happy if there's some interest to work on that with you.
Absolutely interested.
Thank you.
I was also happy to see your investments in a returning citizens portal, because those are services that are desperately needed when many of our residents who are incarcerated far away from D.C. for many years come back to a city that looks different in services that they've not tried to access before. I am confused, however, that you're establishing a portal at the Department of Corrections while still maintaining the Office of Returning Citizens Affairs. How do you envision that these two offices would work together? And are you concerned about duplicate efforts or confusion?
No, I'm not, because they really will serve two different functions. We've called it the portal of entry, and it is at the Department of Corrections. And it, council member, is specifically focused on people who are being newly released from DC jail, but also from the Federal Bureau of Prisons. As a condition, prior to their complete release, they would be required to visit the portal of entry. And at the portal of entry, we will ensure that all of the benefits that they are entitled to, they will be connected with, whether it's ID, whether it's Medicaid, all of the housing assistance and referrals we can make. We'll make sure that parole and probation, they understand all of the things that they need to be compliant with. We estimate is the number 360, I think.
365.
Is that monthly?
365 a month is what we can serve. 850 a month is what is released from DOC today.
So we think 850 people, that's kind of the top end, and we estimate that this new portal of entry will be able to accommodate those releases. Now, the Office of Returning Citizens that operates out of the Executive Office of the Mayor serves another function. We have many returning citizens that aren't newly released, but still need additional services from our government. So our Office of Returning Citizens will continue to focus on the upwards of 60,000 people in the district who are returning citizens and will continue to need additional supports.
Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember White. Councilmember Evans.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And again, good morning, good afternoon now to everyone. Thank you for your presentations. I want to focus on a couple of areas, going back to my opening comments, the first being debt. My first question is probably to Mr. DeWitt. Again, the charts I talked about, when we first had the ability to borrow money in this city, in 1984, we had a $1.6 billion debt. 1993, 10 years later, we doubled that to $3.2 billion. 2013, we doubled it again to $6.7 billion. And we're on a trajectory by 2023, 10 years later, to be at almost $12 billion in debt. And so it becomes a situation where the debt is looming out there in the future, and it becomes not sustainable if we don't do something today. But getting the ability to do something today with something in the future is something governments aren't good at. Federal government is a great example where our debt is now over $20 trillion and no one seems to know what to do, so we don't deal with it. So, Jeff, if you could just give us the thought process, and to the mayor as well. Sitting here today, we are in good shape, but how are we going to grapple with that ongoing liability that is sitting out there that we need to finance many of the infrastructure projects we have?
Okay. Councilmember, would you mind if I started
sure. I'm sure,
turned,
sure, Mayor.
To the Chief Financial Officer?
Yeah.
So first, let me say this, and I know we're different, right? We're not a state, we're not a city, and so oftentimes when people talk about our debt, they don't know where to put us. Compared to some cities, our debt seems outsized. Compared to some states, is small. So there's a really no comparison to a city, county, state like us in terms of our debt. But given the number of people who live here, having over $10 billion of debt can be challenging. We, of course, are limited to not a debt cap of 17%, and we further have locally limited our borrowing to 12% of our revenue. So we have some internal controls now. That, of course, our ability to borrow changes as our revenues increase. And so I think that there are a lot of things that we need to do, Mr. Chairman, around planning to be able to accommodate all of the things that we all want. We want a state of good repair on our roads. We want our buildings to be in good shape. We want to speed up the $1.5 billion that we need for schools. We want to invest in economic development projects that allow us to create more and more jobs. And so it's our intent always to make our borrowing focus on those things that lead to more economic growth. And so that's how we approach the proposal we send to you. But I share your and Mr. Mendelson's concern that we kind of get together, pull all of our needs like Jeff has done, and $3.5 billion, and come up with a long-term plan.
Yeah. And that's helpful. I don't know if you have anything to add to that.
Just to echo everything the mayor said, mm-hmm. our infrastructure needs, because we're a city, state, county, and school district, are large. And the infrastructure, long-range infrastructure finance plan, recommend to go to the 12% cap where we can keep the borrowing at a reasonable level, and then add the pay-as-you-go funding to it. And so we do need to get to that level, but we need to maintain all the other financial disciplines in place to ensure that at that level we can borrow efficiently. Yep. But it is constraining the other things you can do, because you gotta find the money for the debt service, which makes the rest of balancing the budget very difficult, as the mayor knows, and as you will see when you take it over, that puts a constraint on everything else.
Yes. And so I take my fiscal responsible hat off and put on my I want to spend hat. And so when I focus, for instance, on the arts, and that's a real passion of mine, and I get requests, and just to list a couple, for funding that is not in this budget. The Halcyon Arts Lab, the DuPont Underground, the mansion at O Street, the Studio Theater, the National Theater across the street. All of these looking for literally millions of dollars in assistance, both on the operating and the capital side. There was a time years ago when we were able to give huge amounts of money. I mean, this city gave more money to the Harmon Center than Sidney Harmon, $20 million. And we gave more money to Arena Stage than anything, $25 million. And so these requests still keep coming in. So, Mayor, what do we think about how are we going to deal with these requests, particularly with, as you mentioned, the federal government pulling back on their commitment to the arts?
Well, many in the arts advocacy community want a dedicated source, so every year there's not this discussion. So where it might come from, I don't think that we have any more room to talk about dedicating sales tax, or if there's some other fees that we collect that could be dedicated to private facilities. Let's keep in mind, we're not talking about facilities that we own, because we have some of those too, that we have to support. We're talking about private facilities. So just as you mentioned, our support of the Shakespeare Theater to get it built, they also need now help to keep it maintained. The district kind of didn't sign on for that, but if we are recognizing that our arts institutions can't keep up with their operations and maintenance, it may be time for the conversation about if people want to support a new revenue source for them. Now, this budget does not include any earmarks. We do maintain funding, I think, save for a capital allocation made by the council last year. And we will, out of the things that you mentioned, I've asked our DMPED to, I think there is a utility issue with the DuPont Underground that I think we can support in FY17.
Yeah, and I appreciate your support for, first of all, Jellif. Jellif is a rec center, as you may know, that when I travel the city, most people have played basketball at Jellif or are playing basketball. It's probably the most utilized. Yeah, your kids did, my kids did. Everybody does. And it is a rec center in need of help. And thank you for putting in $2 million to begin looking at what we can do at Jellif. I'd love to see two basketball courts there instead of one. You know, whatever we can do to increase the use of that. And Enstead Park is another one.
Yes.
Where, a little clubhouse that needs to be enhanced so that our children have a place to play. So thanks for doing that. And then in my remaining time, you know, the looming issue is Metro. So what's your thoughts on, you know the problems, you were there, I'm here. What are we gonna do going forward on Metro?
Well, Jack, we increased the Metro budget this year. The operating budget is all operating by $60 million.
Yeah.
And I want to acknowledge the chairman and all of the council members for, I think we put aside some of the travel tax money in a fund that made that hit this year not as bad as it could be next year. We were able to use some reserved funds that were meant for a Metro emergency in this very substantial increase in Metro funding. And so I think that while we all have our fingers crossed that our regional partners will get it together, and I think they will. I don't know if it will be an 18, but that is how hard we're pushing. I have to say, I think that the CFO has been very incredible in working with the members of COG and his counterparts in the jurisdictions to making the financial case. I think what remains is a political case, quite frankly, that the leaders in the other jurisdictions have to grapple with.
Well, and I want to thank you for your leadership on that issue. You have been out front in calling for a dedicated funding source in the face of, you know, foot dragging by other jurisdictions. And so I think collectively we have our hands full going forward to do that. That's all the questions I have on this. But again, I want to thank you for funding of many things that are important to Ward 2 and to the city. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilmember Evans. Councilmember Todd.
Yes, thank you, Chairman, and thank you again, Mayor Bowser, and to your
thank
team
you.
And to our CFO for being here to present your budget to the DC Council. I'll start with one of my favorite topics, which is senior citizens in Ward 4 having the opportunity to represent the second highest number in the city, over 17,000 seniors strong. I was pleased to see that the Office on Aging's budget was increased with more resources, and the Office on Aging will be able to ensure that DC seniors are being provided with the services that they need, particularly the $3 million of funding that is allocated for consumer information assistance and outreach programs to support the Safe at Home program. Mayor, do you know, or City Administrator, how many seniors will benefit from this additional funding? Particularly around the Safe at Home program.
Sure, and thank you for that, council member. And we were pleased to make several investments, as you noted, in the Office on Aging's budget. They will also include, in addition to Safe at Home, more transportation services and support of senior villages. The Safe at Home program has been wildly popular, which demonstrates the significant need that's out there. And it's so important because it allows us and it allows seniors to be able to age in place in their homes. We'll never be able to create enough senior housing. So the best senior housing is what people have and modifying it so that they can live there and live there a long time. I had a key requirement that I charged my team with, and that's to make sure that Safe at Home doesn't take 2 years to apply for and get implemented. And I think the team has done exactly that. So I'm gonna ask the city administrator to talk about our experience thus far and what we're looking forward to.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor. Council member, thank you for the question. At the end of fiscal year 16, we were able to serve or complete 193 projects. In fiscal year 17, we think that we will be able to have accomplished over 800 projects with Safe at Home. And we think for fiscal year 18, we'll be able to serve roughly 500 new clients through that program. So we've worked hard in matching local dollars with federal dollars. There's $3 million in this local budget plus $3.5 million of CDBG funds that will come from the Department of Housing and Community Development to have a total resource of $6.5 million to be able to implement this program in fiscal 18.
Okay, thank you. That's very helpful. I was also very excited to see that this budget includes $1 million for the establishment of a nurse triage collaborative pilot program between Fire and Emergency Management Services and the Office of Unified Communications. As you know, some of the most northern neighborhoods in Ward 4 suffer from response times, which is why I'm very excited to see Engine Company 22 yes. Moving full steam ahead, which will provide the critical response times needed in Upper Northwest Washington, D.C. Can you discuss how this pilot will help address some of those issues or how it would be implemented?
Well, Councilmember, thank you. In addition to being able to help, and I think by later this year, we won't have to say that those neighborhoods have longer distances to travel to get emergency vehicles because Engine 22 will open. But the nurse triage unit, is going to be helpful for the entire city. What it aims to do is to get people who don't have emergencies out of the emergency system. Mm-hmm. So they won't be on an ambulance and they won't be in the emergency room, which means that people who are experiencing emergencies have more vehicles available and will have shorter times to wait once they get to the emergency room. And I think that will have an impact that will have an impact across the city.
Okay, thank you, Mayor. My next question will be around statehood. First, let me thank you and your team for your stellar support around us becoming the 51st state. I think it's been notably noticed across the city and certainly in Ward 4. Achieving statehood is important to this government and district residents. And last month, I introduced legislation to provide support to the new Columbia Statehood Fund to further the goals of statehood. And I'm very encouraged to see in your budget includes $952,000 for a campaign to market the importance of statehood both inside the District of Columbia and outside, and I fully support this measure. Can you discuss how your administration believes this funding can be used to advocate for district statehood?
Thank you, Councilmember. I've been thinking about this funding for each of my budgets. And what I told our team is that we're gonna see what the residents of the District of Columbia want. And their vote last November 8th told me they wanted us to focus and to do more and to think differently about how we achieve statehood for the residents of the District of Columbia. That's why it gives me confidence to make this this request to the council at this time for $952,000 to support a statehood effort. Now our team, we expect to have a dedicated staff person and a national and local campaign that is going to, there's going to be some targeting of states and advocacy groups to support us in this effort. This effort will continue to be led out of my Office for Federal and Regional Affairs, and we would, of course, work in concert with our statehood delegation and the Statehood Commission, and we would set up goals annually and seek to meet them.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. And my next question, I guess, may be appropriate for you or Mr. DeWitt. As we determine additional tax triggers will happen this year, as we have determined, pardon me, that additional tax triggers will happen this year. On the other side, however, does this budget and your efforts account for added tax and enforcement efforts for the underground economy, which I think is growing as our city continues to grow?
Can you tell me more, council member? So, when you say the underground economy, are you referring to a specific activity?
So people who aren't paying taxes that should pay, how are we enforcing them to pay taxes? And does this budget put more resources behind that?
I can take that. Council member, we are in the process of putting in a new tax system that does give us a lot more capability than we've ever had before in terms of transparency on that. And one of the things over the next probably 6 to 12 months, there's gonna be a lot of effort in the compliance area for OTR, one of our seven strategic objectives in the CFO's office is fair and full collection of taxes to ensure that everybody is paying their fair share. So we will be using the new system, the new technology, and then focusing on some efforts in compliance to ensure that people are paying their fair share of taxes, to answer your question.
Okay, that's helpful, thank you. And I could probably ask questions all morning, and again, I wanna thank you, Mayor, for working with myself and the residents of Ward 4 and certainly all across the city to have what I think is a budget that reflects my values, the 82,000 people that I represent's values, investments in education, transportation, seniors, and our public facilities. So thank you, and I look forward to continuing to work with you over these next 50 or so days so we can pass the budget. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Council Member.
Thank you, Mr. Councilmember. Councilmember Trayon White.
Thank you, Chairman Mendelson. Thank you all for coming this morning. It's been an exciting time for the district residents to hear where we are headed. And I think that we are going in a good direction, but we would like to see more and more. So my first question is, as you are aware, the food access has worsened in Ward 7 and 8 with only three grocery stores serving 150,000 residents. This is, so we wanna know, do you have a plan in this budget to address the need for food in Ward 7 and 8? Not just a want that we have, but it's definitely a need. A lot of times the residents go inside the stores, the shelves are almost empty and the food does not really have quality and it's more expensive if you look at the prices compared to other wards, grocery stores.
Thank you, Council Member, and I couldn't agree with you more that there should be more than one full-service grocer serving the almost 80,000 people of Ward 8. It's been my experience that investing in corridors and in economic development strategy is what will attract a full service grocer. So we've been very focused on certain nodes in Ward 8 that we know if we invest a lot of resources in, we would be more likely to attract a full service grocer. We have a tremendous amount of course, as you have noted, activity at the St. Elizabeth's campus with infrastructure, with the sports and entertainment, with the facility that we're proposing and the first phase of the housing development. So we know that has a lot of activity around it. Now, it's not that far from the existing full service grocer, but there still may be opportunities there. We continue to fund, as you have noted, Council Member, the Healthy Corners program expansion, which allows us to encourage all kinds of retailers to offer fresh fruits, for example, and milk that add to the healthy options available to people as well. We are chewing on an idea of a public space that we have, not a public space, but a development that the city has been involved in that may allow us to build on your idea of incubating a space. We don't know about, I can't say for sure yet, but I'd like to talk to you about some ideas that we have. And if it doesn't work out in that case, there may be future opportunities where we could help incubate a space. You've suggested a nonprofit provider, but there may be some ideas around that we could jumpstart some ideas.
Thank you. Next, the interim police chief Newsom stated that I don't think anyone who knows anything about crime would agree that more police equals less crime. And there are strategies to reduce crime other than to say that let's hire a bunch of cops. With that said, what strategies do we have to reduce crime other than police, more police in this budget?
Well, this budget reflects making sure that we are hiring and retaining quality police officers who want to work with the community, want to do community policing, and want to help us drive down crime. And if there are crimes committed, make sure that justice will be served. We also are funding a lot of preventative efforts. I think that you would agree with me that the best way to keep people from crime is to make sure they have access to opportunity. That's why we've been so focused, council member, over the last 2 years on making sure that programs like SYEP were expanded to 22 to 24-year-olds, that we established career connections, which actually I think is in the spirit of a program that council member McDuffie proposed in the NEAR Act, but Career Connections has allowed us to very quickly turn around just as involve young people up through the age of 24 to give them training and job opportunities, so that's been very helpful. We've also focused on Aspire, which is a program that we have created that helps returning citizens start businesses, and we're seeing very early success with those programs as well. So our focus on jobs has been heavily weighted, and a lot of the participants in those programs, the significant number, are from Ward 8.
Thank you. And looking through the budget, I noticed that they were funding for Anacostia High School decreased in almost every category. Upon further review, my team and I found that a number of public schools in Ward 8 have also decreased in funding. For example, Kramer, Ketchum, Moulton, Patterson, Savoy, and Simon.
Are you talking about operations or capital? Are you talking about the buildings themselves or the school operations, council member?
Operations.
Okay. I'm not sure if I have those specifically with me in front of me, so let me see what might be happening there.
Okay. She will get back to us on the actual specifics.
I will get back to you, absolutely. All right.
Thank you. As metro fares continue to increase while service levels decrease, I know there's been a lot of talk about metro since I've been here. There's an increasing strain on residents east of the Anacostia River who rely on these services who have modest incomes, as you know. Previously, there were bus subsidies for certain lines east of the river to support lower-income residents. Have you given consideration to revisiting transportation subsidies east of the Anacostia River?
I haven't beyond what we're doing in terms of kids ride free on Metro Bus and Metro Rail. We continue to have growing demand for that program, which is a big benefit to DC parents. What we found were parents were spending $30 or more per child to send their young person to school. And you are right to point out the impact on people from Ward 8, because we saw that they traveled outside of their neighborhood to school in pretty large numbers. So the Kids Ride Free and Kids Ride Free on Rail programs largely benefit, have a huge impact on residents of Ward 8. Now we haven't, and I'm happy to talk to you about that some more to learn what you might be proposing. We haven't considered a new program. Another thing that we've added some bus service, and I think one thing that we have to look at in terms of helping people in Ward 8 with transportation is make sure the services that are there are working better, especially on the bus.
Thank you. I don't know if you saw or not, but I introduced a bill to reduce the doubling of tickets in Washington, D.C. I know under previous administrations under Mayor Gray and Mayor Fenty, they had some type of initiatives to address the ticketing in D.C. I want to know your thoughts on the bill I introduced, and also what's your thoughts on, I forgot the name of it, but it was kind of like you get the chance to pay your bills back in half.
Amnesty program?
Yes, that's it.
Yeah. I like to look into an amnesty at some point, and we can identify an amount, and if there is an ability to do it in FY17, I would look at it. It's not, it's not something that I can say now what that amount could be or how many people would be served, but it is an idea that I have floated from time to time.
I would like the CFO to weigh in on that if he has something to add to that.
I know he has something to say.
But I'm waiting to hear it.
Well, like I always do, what's it going to cost? I mean, that's yeah. Where I come in at. So I think we're looking at the fiscal impacts of that and what it is. And then that would be, if the bill were to be brought forward, is what is the impact and how do you fund it? But I don't have that number done yet in terms of what that impact is.
Okay. I know what I think we generated about $46 million. at the one point that you reported when we first spoke at a hearing, and I asked, was this necessary to balance the budget for DC government? And you said no. Do you still?
Yeah, we have the amount that we collect from fines and fees. The question for the particular bill you're talking about is, what do we collect from those people who pay late?
Yeah.
What's the impact of that? We don't have that analysis completed yet. But when we do, we'll be sure to forward it to you and the members of the council if you want to go forward with a bill on that.
Thank you. It's been reported that many of the child care providers serving low and moderate income families are struggling to make ends meet and pay workers, in part due to our current child care reimbursement rate. The budget does not contain a change in the child care reimbursement rate. Do we have any plans to relieve the pressures for these providers?
Right now, council member, this budget contemplates a new child care initiative that's focused on increasing the number of seats. We will continue our focus as well on supporting quality and supporting teacher training at all of our centers. There remains work to do, as I mentioned to council member Silverman, and we'll look forward to ways to also with you to have initiatives related to those seats as well.
Thank you, Chairman Mendelson. Well, I gotta ask another one. What
you want to do? Go ahead, Councilman.
All right.
I think you got it.
At-risk funds are supposed to help schools provide a new resource for the low-income students and other students at risk falling behind academically, especially African-American boys. We see the gap widening and widening in achievement for African-American boys. But nearly half of the dedicated at-risk funding in DCPS this year is going to pay for core functions instead of driving additional targeted resources like after-school programs or even in credit recovery. How does your budget address the problem given a 1.5% increase to the schools?
Chancellor Wilson and I have had this conversation, and he's very focused on ensuring that the at-risk funding is doing what it's intending to do, and that is to drive the achievement for students who need more resources. And sometimes that can happen at the school level, and the schools will know exactly what and how to do it. And sometimes they can be focused on programs that are scaled at the central office level and implemented at the schools. And I support that approach.
Councilmember White.
Thank you very much. Councilmember Gray for questions.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Good morning again, Madam Mayor.
And good morning,
those
Mr.
with you.
Councilmember.
Madam Mayor, I assume at your request, your staff reached out to me in my office suggesting that we submit request that we had for the budget. First of all, let me thank you for reaching out to do that. And then in the aftermath of now reviewing the budget, I realized that most of it didn't make it, which is your decision, of course. One of those things that is hugely important to me, and I would assume is important to you, and that is the health care of people on the East End of the District of Columbia.
Yes.
There's been much discussion about that. There's been much action, and you will probably recall, because you were on the council at the time, that I had included in my last budget as mayor the construction of a new hospital for the people on the East End. Even it proposed that it be constructed on an existing site, and that is the St. Elizabeth's Hospital site. I included that request in what went forward in the letter that we submitted. And it's not just the building of a hospital. It's really trying to address something more fundamental than that, and that is the fact that there really is no healthcare system, no integrated healthcare system that exists on the east end of the city. There's a clinic here, and we have the United Medical Center, et cetera. I've looked at this budget, and I'm frankly trying to figure out what exactly there is in there. I know that there's $180 million in the capital budget for a hospital that goes out to fiscal year 22 or 23, which is a long ways down the road, obviously. I know also, having followed this fairly closely, that there's probably $95 or $96 million left in the existing capital budget. So this adds another $86 million. Can you explain to me what the vision is for that expenditure and exactly what it is that you anticipate being able to do with $180 million when I think we both would recognize that's not going to build a hospital, and it's What are we supposed to tell the people on the east end of the District of Columbia who have spent a lot of time and a lot of energy and a lot of emotion thinking about having a broader, better healthcare system and then being able to have a hospital that can be an anchor for a healthcare system on the east end of the city?
Sure, Council Member. Well, I certainly share your passion for delivering a full-service, high-quality new hospital on the eastern part of our city. And I know you have been working on this for a number of years. It probably dates back to when you were first the Ward 7 Council Member. And I've been working on it since I've been on the Council as well, from when the city decided to become involved in the hospital. So for a number of years, I think we have all been focused on how to solve a complicated issue and for the residents of Ward 7 and 8 and all DC residents, in fact. We should aim to build a hospital where no matter where you live in the district, you would think of UMC as a quality place to get health care. So let me just start there. And we all recognize that it's complicated and difficult, or otherwise we would have solved it by now.
But we could have solved it in the last budget I had as mayor, and this council was the one that took it out of the budget, Madam Mayor. So we could have solved this before now.
Well,
so I don't want to leave the impression that this is an unbelievably complicated issue. I don't think it's that complicated, to tell you the truth.
Well, it's been around for a while, so I won't debate with you how complicated it is, but it has certainly been a longstanding problem for us to solve. Let me say this also, Council Member, that it's not just a real estate issue that we're dealing with, and I know you recognize that. It's not just a decision of how much money is in the budget, because we could have it fully funded. Nobody, I think you requested that we put $230 million in the budget. We landed at $180 million, and I've heard estimates as high up as $600 million to build a new hospital. So neither your request or what we have, and I don't know what it's going to be ultimately, but I don't think that $230 would get us there either. What we need is we need a healthy hospital operation, which we've been very focused on working with the board over the last 2 years, and we also need a partner. The District of Columbia has said over the course of several years that we want to be out of the hospital business. We're not a good operator of hospitals, and so we are looking for a partner to come in with us, and frankly, we would like them to be a capital partner as well. So we have worked over the last 2 years, and I want to thank the CFO for his help in getting the operations healthy, then we know that we will be able to attract a partner that can be solid with us, and we can get out of the business of operating the hospital.
With all due respect, Madam Mayor, there's nobody that's going to, and I've talked to a lot of hospitals in this, there's nobody that's going to take over, excuse me, the operation of the United Medical Center without some clear indication that there's going to be a new hospital. And
let me finish.
I wouldn't do it either if I were them, because it's a 51-year-old facility that is, you know, at best we put baling wire and chewing gum on it to keep it operating. So I don't understand whether there's going to be a new hospital. Let me just finish my point, Madam Mayor.
Sure.
And that is, I don't understand what it is that we're supposed to expect that will be done with this $180 million. I would assume you would acknowledge we can't build a hospital for that. You talked about $600 million, which I think is way overstated.
I think it's overstated too.
Yeah, so, but you use that number. And I would like to put that aside, because I don't think that's realistic at all. There have been community hospitals, and that's what we need. We don't need another 450-bed hospital on the east end of the city. What we need is a hospital that's about 200 beds, recognizing the improvements that have been made in medical technology in the last several years. So I'm going to go back to what my original question is. What are we supposed to do? What is it I'm supposed to tell the people on the east end of the city with $180 million in this budget? Because I don't think you can build anything with that.
Well, I've certainly been focused on improving the operations at UMC for the last 2 years, attracting a partner that can operate the hospital and seek to partner with us on the capital investment. If I thought that we had a partner, I have no reason to think we won't be able to get the money that we need.
Well, I don't know how you get a partner without a commitment. There is no commitment in this budget. If I were a hospital CEO having to make these kinds of decisions, There's very little in this budget that would convince me that the District of Columbia, the mayor, is serious about making this happen, because you can't build anything with $180 million. And they will figure that out in about 3.5 milliseconds if they haven't already. So I don't know where we go from here, because $180 million will do nothing to advance that cause. And again, I want to be absolutely clear that what's important to me is to build a real integrated healthcare system which does not exist. It's absurd that we don't even have an urgent care center east of North Capitol Street in the District of Columbia. And this was an opportunity with what I had advanced in the letter that went to you to be able to address the absurdity of that. Let me just give you a specific example and I'll go into something else. I looked at Providence Hospital's statistics. Last year, they had 10,000 people who came from zip codes 219, 220, 232. That's a lot of people who have basically voted with their feet, leaving the east end of the city to go elsewhere to get health care that they don't perceive being available to them where they live. So what are we supposed to tell, what am I supposed to tell people at this stage about what was to do with $180 million? And I'm not going to tell them that we need to find an operator, because until there's a commitment made to what we're going to do, there is no credible operator that will step forward.
Well, our commitment is clear, and we want to build a hospital, a new hospital east of the river.
Well, it's not clear to me, and the best way to make something clear is by to put the dollars on the table. There are other things that you've advanced in this budget that are designed to send the message to people that we're serious about something. This doesn't send the message at all that
we're
serious.
Well, respectfully, Mr. Gray, I would disagree with that. This council, and you will recall, you've referenced it, wasn't satisfied with the plan that was advanced in 2014. They didn't think it was real. They weren't satisfied with the partnership that was advanced. They didn't think it was stable, and they didn't think that it would make the hospital better. So while we've been focused on it for 2 years, I know you've been working on it a lot longer, and I think that we are closer than we've been before to getting there.
Well, I respectfully disagree with you, and you've had 2 years to work on it, and I don't see where the progress is, quite frankly. My time is up on this round, and I guess we'll just have to wait for some of the rest of this for the city administrator, but I just don't believe that with $180 million, which is simply adding another 80 plus million dollars to what already exists, and that is the 96 that's in the budget. To me, it's just a disingenuous commitment, if that we can call it that, to healthcare on the east end of the District of Columbia, where we have some of the worst disparities in the entirety of the District of Columbia.
Thank you, Councilmember Gray. Councilmember Nadeau for questions.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And Mayor, thank you earlier for your comments to Councilmember Evans in support of the DuPont Underground utility connection. You know that's something that I'm interested in as well. I think it's going to be a really great art space if we can get them what they need down there. I wanted to talk to you about two things in the Human Services Committee.
Yes.
First, TANF. I'm hoping you can walk us through your vision for the new TANF program and also how it differs from the preferred option in the working group.
Absolutely, Council Member. What we attempt to do is reform TANF and to discontinue kind of stopgap extensions. You will remember some years ago that the council moved to limit TANF to 60 months. And the program then is sort of the program that was in existence when I became mayor. It was something that I think that we were all well-intentioned in doing to try to reform TANF and encourage work. But what it effectively would have done in 2015 is send 6,000 people over the cliff. That means they would be entirely cut off, adults and children, from any type of assistance. And already they were living on a meager $150 per month. I would not allow that cliff in our first budget, so I extended it. In the second budget, I extended it again, but I also committed to work with all of you to make sure we reformed the program. So now what we will have is a system that will always support children. And regardless of the work activity of the parent, it will always support children. The second, so one half of the TANF payment, one half of the TANF payment would be dedicated to the support of children. And the other half of the TANF payment would be focused on the support of the adult in the household. And there are requirements for education and work for the adult to continue to receive those payments. And there are sanctions if those activities aren't met. So additionally, the payment was right-sized for families, and we just won't have people worried about a cliff, but we have a very intense focus on focusing resources towards quality programs that are gonna get them to sustainable jobs.
Thank you very much. I look forward to working with the team as we go through the budget on that. You know, my proposal is slightly different, and so, but I think we're very close.
Okay.
So I think, you know, I think we can get there. And I also wanted to ask if you could walk me through the Homeward DC budget.
Sure.
What comes out, you know, what programs are going to be funded through that, and whether you have a sense of if there's more that needs to go in.
Well, absolutely. So you will know that we have committed to Homeward DC in each of our budgets. I think our first budget, we had $21 million toward Homeward DC, $17 million last year. And this year we have a combination of investments from DHS and the Housing Authority. So I'm gonna ask the CA to talk about that in a little more detail.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor. Councilmember, thank you for that question. So in Homeward DC, we are investing about $15.2 million in advancement of that strategy. That investment delivers 270 units of permanent supportive housing, 185 units of targeted affordable housing, 130 units of rapid rehousing, and 80 units that focus on our youth plan. I will point out that in addition to that $15.2 million, as the Homeward DC strategic plan contemplates, there's $36 million additional dollars of local resources for our continuum of care contract as well. And then certainly the expenditures that we're making to support the family services system. So there's about $2 million in DHS's operating budget to support the operating costs for the expected capital investment that we have for the closure of DC General, as well as roughly $130 million in capital resources to implement the short-term family housing plan that's contemplated for that closure of DC General as well.
And where does that put us in terms of our overall progress on Homeward DC?
So what I would tell you, Councilmember, is that the Homeward DC plan in contemplating implementation resources took the most, and I don't begrudge that, actually voted for it as the chair of the ICH, took the most aggressive posture in terms of implementing what we need to do in terms of reforms. And so we aren't at the levels that were contemplated by the plan, but again, the plan assumed the most aggressive implementation schedule under all of the scenarios that they considered. What we've tried to do in each year, each of our 3 years of making recommendations, is size that investment to what the capacity is for us to deliver. How many units can we actually deliver? How can we manage the systems reforms required or suggested and contemplated under Homeward DC? And that's what this budget reflects. So it doesn't mirror the most aggressive scenario, but it does factor the ability for us to implement those deliverables.
Do you have a projection for where we'll be at the end of 2017 for unit counts in these areas?
We can provide the roll-up of our successive years of investments and total units produced under our investments at Homeward DC. We can give you that supplemental information.
And what's the number for LRSP in this budget?
6.4 million dollars. That of the 15.2, 6.4 million goes to the Housing Authority for LRSP.
And how many units is that?
That is included in the units that I gave you at the beginning. So we have counted the LRSP investments in all of the other housing initiatives that I just talked about.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember Nadeau. Councilmember Silverman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Madam Mayor, I want to ask about a few of the new initiatives that are in the budget. First is the Infrastructure Academy.
Yes.
I certainly agree that we should maximize our investment in our public works projects by getting an additional return on investment of jobs. But can you tell me a little bit more about what we're spending money on and what does this look like?
Sure. I'm going to turn to the city administrator to talk about this, but we will build a facility. We expect that it will be built at St. Elizabeth's. It will be both a training site and hiring site, and we will align it with available jobs on major projects that from the partner agencies that I just mentioned.
Okay.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Councilmember, we in fact will be, as the mayor indicated, constructing a building, and then we anticipate or contemplate having specialized and directed training for those industry partners that are working with us on the development of the academy. So specifically, overhead line persons, utility, gas installation kinds of jobs, mechanics jobs, general utility management work.
Okay. One of the concerns in the job training sphere is that we train people in classroom-based learning instead of work-based learning. So help me understand the building of the facility. My understanding is that we're partnering with some of our large utilities. Like, is it necessary to build a facility, or could we do some of this work-based learning on site? What was the decision to make that upfront investment in a facility rather than make, let's say, an investment in the training modules, or perhaps help the utilities to just expand where they do their current training and
sure.
Enhance that?
Yeah, a couple things. So the utilities do have training facilities and training opportunities now, and it really is for their existing staff. They don't have the kind of training, both classroom and experiential, that allows a person to have an entry level opportunity with their organization. This program and what we're suggesting is modeled after a very successful program that exists in Chicago with a partnership between ComEd, which is the utility company there, and King County Community College, which is one of the community colleges in Chicago, that has a site-based training program that brings individuals through different lines of business and discipline that leads to what is a remarkable placement rate for those individuals that complete the training, which is 80%. So 80% of the people who complete the training at the facility that has been in existence for nearly 7 years in Chicago get placed in entry-level jobs with one of the industry partners. And so we're modeling this program over what we have seen to be a successful program in Chicago.
Will this include other, infrastructure, I believe, was just recently added as one of our high sector industries that the our Workforce Investment Council considers high, one of our high demand industries. But some of our other high demand industries have been asking for similar training space. For example, our culinary and hospitality industry has been asking for example, additional kitchen training facilities. Could this include that as well?
What we have been focused on to date have been those utility and infrastructure related jobs, in part because of the successful negotiation we were able to have with utility around the merger. And so those resources will be leveraged against our own investment to create this facility to work on those specific lines of business.
And so can you just give me a sense of the time frame of the training set? When will how long will it take to build the training center, and then when will people actually start to receive the training?
So we have contemplated in the capital budget resources in fiscal years 19, 20, and 21, a year of design, up to 2 years of construction. But that is not to say we can't start, to your earlier point, some site-based learning in advance of that construction. And so the unique opportunity that we have here is the commitment from industry to really work very closely with us to tailor this kind of program to meet their needs. And so as we continue those conversations, it might be possible and preferable for us to start something in fiscal 18 while we construct this facility over the next couple of years.
Let me move to the childcare program. Certainly, as has been mentioned, after housing costs, childcare, I think, is one of the most common concerns that we hear all across the city. And I'm glad to see that you put additional resources in, but I just want to understand the new initiative. So as I understand it, the budget dedicates $13 million for new grants to child care centers to open or expand, and an additional $2 million to open child care centers in district-owned buildings. Is that correct?
Councilmember, the $13 million that we're referring to is both for the expansion of existing facilities to incent new facilities to include those in government buildings. So it is not a separate sort of assumption of the budget. It is contained within that $13 million.
Can you, so as has been mentioned by several members, the subsidy, the child care subsidy, has not been increased in a long time. And in fact, it makes the economics of operating a child care center, if you accept these vouchers, just very, very difficult. Can you give me your thinking as to why not also make an effort to increase the subsidy?
We certainly want to work with you on the best ways to improve child care centers and also to improve the experience for parents and children and the quality of those child care centers. And that has chiefly been our focus on quality. And we cannot ignore that there simply is not space. There are not infant and toddler child care slots in the district. People are waiting 5, 6, 7 months. A woman told me the story yesterday that as soon as she found out she was pregnant, she immediately, before she told her family, she was trying to get on a waiting list. So that is how dire in many parts of our city it is.
Okay. Let me ask about the another pilot project. That's in the Deputy Mayor for Greater Economic Opportunities budget called Local Business Utilization. I hadn't heard of this before, and it hadn't come up in the performance hearing we had with the agency. Can you help me understand this pilot and what it does?
Yes, it is to be started, so that's probably why it wasn't discussed in the performance hearing, and it is a new strategy that we want to employ to have more small and local and resident-owned businesses involved in working with the district. Our idea is that we are going to make sure that there is more of a start-to-finish compliance and monitoring compliance and monitoring aspect to how we work with small and local businesses. But the city administrator has been very involved in working with the DMGO about how we launch this.
Thank you, Mayor. The other thing that I'll add, Council Member, is that what we're really also trying to do is to provide a higher level of touch and technical assistance to our small businesses and resident-owned businesses. We know that the contracting opportunities are significant, and we certainly want all of our agencies to comply with the 35% and exceed the 35% subcontracting rule. And so the idea is that we want resources that helps the procurement staff think through the best way to package and bundle contract opportunities to the maximum benefit of our small business and resident-owned businesses, so that they can make suggestions to the procurement staff about how we might let trade contracts out, for example. And also, once the procurement process begins, making sure that the technical assistance is there for the small business and resident-owned business to comply with our requirements and have the right forms and the right certifications so they can be the most competitive when they submit their bid.
And one more question. A follow-up to the question about the trust fund. I noticed that a lot of the DHCD employees charge at least half their time to the trust fund, which then increases the administrative expenses. Is this a concern to you? Have you noticed this? How do we control the administrative costs of the trust fund?
Council member, it is a very common occurrence for governments and even in private sectors with respect to capital, but governments to charge an overhead cost for projects to federal funds and certain designated funds. And so it's a very common practice to do. The reason that the administrative overhead is required, or the local infusion is required, is because they're working on more projects from prior years and can't charge to the current year, and again, the issue with the federal cap, but it is a common practice that we think is managed judiciously.
I understand that explanation. With your indulgence, Mr. Chairman, I just want to finish in lieu of another round.
No, if there's no objection.
Thank you. So I understand that explanation, Mr. City Administrator, but I think my concern is that some of the employees who are charging their salary to the trust fund spend less than half their time on the trust fund. So it isn't an issue of trust fund expenses, but it's an issue that we might be using the trust fund to pay for other program costs.
Councilmember, that's why we have recommended the change in structure that we have. There's, in addition to the 5% carryover charge that we're talking about, there's still an additional $2 million of local funds to help better align the work that they do to the right charging account.
Okay, well, I look forward to following up with you on this. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilmember Silverman. Councilmember McDuffie.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you again, Madam Mayor. I don't have very many questions here, but I do want to ask about Brown Education Campus. It's something that we've had conversations about in your tenure as mayor, and it's something that I bring up almost every year because we've not gotten a commitment to put the money in the CIP to renovate Brown, and I know that you did put it in this year's CIP, but it is, I believe, merely $3.6
million. I think it's planning dollars, yes.
In the six-year CIP, and it's in the last year of that six-year CIP. And I guess I'm just curious as to whether or not there are any other schools that weren't in last year's CIP but are now a part of the CIP.
Yes. I think that the Capitol Hill Montessori is one, okay. And there's one other that was added that was outside. I think we were able to advance all of the schools except three into a planning phase.
Okay.
Yes, the city administrator
has
to
list. So there are eight projects that will start in design, with design in 22 and finish in 24. They include Aton, Francis, Stevens, Brown, Eaton, Goading, Green, Raymond, and Smothers. There are three that still remain outside of the CIP. That's Washington Metro, Logan, and Adams.
Okay. And the earliest, I think you mentioned that any of them were added, is 2022?
So planning and design for the first eight that I mentioned began in 22. With then construction would be in 23 and 24.
Were there any schools in the CIP that were moved up, that were already in the CIP slated for construction, were moved up in the CIP?
No school, let me double check. The start of construction did not move up. I think in three instances, we were able to finish 1 year earlier.
I think that's Jefferson, which went from 4 years to 3 years. Raymond and Smothers.
Okay. I want the record reflect that I think that I appreciate the inclusion of Brown into the CIP, but I really don't think that 3.6 in 2023 sends a signal to those residents and those parents in the Langston and Carver neighborhoods that the district is serious about trying to improve their school building. They've been, I think, really challenged, and I know the principal there has been, you know, really committed, and they've been working hard on their IB program. And I'd like to see us identify some funds to move it up in the CIP and then really get going with some renovations to that school. But let me move on and talk about the NEARAC. I was pleased, as I'm sure lots of advocates and law professors and others who had advocated for the funding of the NEARAC. So I was pleased to see it in the budget, which I think is in the budget. I saw money increases by $970,000+ in MPD's budget to hire 5 social workers and 5 clinical psychologists, I believe from DBH. And there was a $630,000 to fund FTEs for violence interruption and prevention in the Deputy Mayor for Public Safety and Justice's budget. I think there's also an FTE, or at least a $100,000 increase for program oversight. Are all those numbers that I just mentioned, are they specifically to implement the NEARAC law?
Yes. And so we are adding, and let me just focus on 3 things, council member. You already mentioned what I don't know what everybody else calls it. I call it the DBH co-response. Mm-hmm. And that was the first item that you mentioned that's about $970,000. DBH and MPD are now working on protocols to inform how DBH and MPD can work together. We are also trying to identify alternate space. If in fact someone is having a medical crisis and they don't need to go to the jail, but they need to go to another safe place, then we are working to have that implemented. I think you know we've already been working on social work response to emergency rooms where there's been a violent crime, and we are committing to building on that and expanding on that in this financial plan. The last part, I'm just going to start and have the city administrator talk about how we are leveraging our existing and adding violence prevention outreach and initiatives to our stabilization team, to our safer and stronger team, and to some existing FTEs in other parts of the government.
Let me ask a question. I noticed the subtitle you sent down to essentially implement what was passed last year as the Office of Neighborhood Safety and Engagement, it appears to change the name to something different. What's the thought behind the change of the name?
Sometimes we want to it probably was a reflection on the existing lease resources that we're leveraging into the new program.
Okay, but I mean, you all aren't wedded to the name that came down. It could go back to what was in the law originally. Is that okay?
Well, perhaps you're not wedded to that, and we can talk about it.
Well, I thought we actually had talked about it previously. I thought we talked about it in 2015.
I have one other name change that I like to recommend, too.
Okay. I thought we talked about it in 2015, and actually we changed the name previously.
Oh, did we? Okay.
To accommodate you all.
All right. I'm not remembering that. So okay. Let's can we revisit that?
Gotcha.
Thank you.
Gotcha. Let me ask a question about the Deputy Mayor for Planning and Economic Development, specifically the Great Streets program. It appears that the proposed budget reduces the allocation for the Great Streets Initiative by more than $1 million from the current level. If you could explain your rationale behind that and let me know whether or not you believe the program is beginning to show some sort of diminishing returns in terms of its impact for small business corridors in the district?
No, you know, I'm a big supporter of Great Streets and making sure that we have long-term sustainable funding for Great Streets, which we've had a lot of debate about over the last several years. I'm not recalling any reductions to the program, so the CA will respond.
Yeah, Councilmember McDuffie, I'm not familiar with a $1 million reduction for Great Streets, and so I'll have to look at what you're looking at and compare to our numbers to make sure we're talking about the same thing. But okay. I don't recall that we had done that.
Okay. Well, I mean, if it is in fact the case, I would love to be able to work with you all to see if we could fix that.
Okay.
Um, believe I had another question I wanted to ask about the NEAR Act. I was looking back at the FIS that our able CFO in his office provided, and I noticed that some of the money that's been allocated for the NEAR Act in your proposed budget is less than what was indicated would be necessary to fund in the FIS that accompanied the legislation. And I just wanted to see if there were any thoughts about whether that was some examination by you all that there were some efficiencies discovered or just...
Well, which component of the NEAR Act and the FIS are you referring to?
Both the Office of Neighborhood Engagement and Safety called for, there was a higher number. I think maybe that has to do with the amount of FTEs that you all decided to fund. I think that we looked at trying to do more than the five that you all have.
So if it's the Office of Neighborhood Engagement and Safety, I think the FIS for that is $4.9 million. Our investment is $5.7 million, and I think the difference is the additional FTEs that we are recommending for the stabilization team. There are five FTEs, roughly $560,000, I think, is the cost that we've added to the budget.
Okay. And so you all have funded adequately. Do you have a breakdown? You all have funded the program participant stipend at the same level that was recommended and the cost of supplies and materials and so forth, or no?
No, council member, we are not implementing a stipend, but what we are doing is continuing the Career Connections program. And so
Does that program utilize a stipend?
No, you get paid. It's subsidized employment.
What's the difference between that and a stipend?
You get paid for work.
You get paid to work, and does the program allow folks to enter work immediately, or is there some process that takes place before you enter?
There is a training component that is involved with Career Connections that then could lead to subsidized employment. Both the training component and the subsidized employment, the training component and employment has a paid subsidy.
So you get paid to go through training.
You have subsidized training.
Any other component to it besides training? Any mentorship?
There are wraparound services that come with that, and some case management intervention, if you will.
And you get paid while you go through that as well?
You get paid for the duration of the training to include the services.
So let me just ask, is this an issue of semantics, or is this
I'm not sure. I'm trying to answer exactly how you're asking.
It seems like you all would rather not call it a stipend because it's a controversial phrase, but essentially it is providing somebody a payment while they go through what's fairly important. I think you all would concede as much that training, mentorship, and other wraparound services are important even in advance of actual employment.
Well, I don't know if it's a matter of its semantics, but I think our goal is the same. And so we can call it what you want. But I think what in our discussions, what we agree on is that there are a number of justice-involved people that but for a productive, paid work experience, they might be involved in crime. Okay. And this Career Connections program is not new to this budget, but we've had it in place now since the supplemental we submitted and you supported in late 2015. Quite frankly, council member, we think that it's more successful than we could have imagined.
Okay, but just to be clear, it is your
it
intent
is our
through
intent
this funding to
that
implement
responds,
the law that is on the books in terms of the NEAR Act?
Well, we have not, and if I understand your questions correctly, we have not, to the letter of everything that's listed in the NEAR Act, funded everything that's listed in that FIS.
Okay.
But I do believe that our Career Connections program is responsive to that element of the NEAR Act.
Okay, and would that function, I'm sorry, I've gone over my time, but is that function of Career Connections going to be folded into the Office of Neighborhood Safety and Engagement, or does it remain separate somewhere else?
So Career Connections is managed today in DOES. It would continue to be managed at DOES. It actually folds into a division called State Initiatives at DOES that includes project empowerment and other violence prevention or workforce training programs. So it is not folded into what we are calling the Office of Community Engagement and Neighborhood Safety, or the Office of Neighborhood Engagement and Safety.
Okay. I would love to follow up with you all at some point.
Okay.
Just to get a clear sense of what's included in the office, what the functions are, and just the money that's been allocated, to see where perhaps there's overlap in existing programs.
Sure.
So that there's no effort, you know, to try to duplicate.
Sure.
Things that almost are already in existence. And I appreciate the fact that you all have funded this. And I, at the risk of sounding a little redundant, you know, this program is extremely important to residents. And I think we had a lot of folks who came down to testify in oversight hearings, both in 2015, 16, and 17. And so I am encouraged by this and look forward to seeing these things implemented. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember McDuffie. Madam Mayor, if you want to get about the business of government, you're
Thank
free
you.
To go.
I'll do
I
that.
I think the others
Thank
are
you.
Still trapped.
I can get about the business of government as well, Mr. Chairman.
Your business of government is us.
Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, council members.
Thank you, Madam Mayor.